Baptist Church. Just like my name is Gary Thompson, I'm one of the elders here at Faith. Just a few announcements that we have here this evening. Again, welcome. Regarding washrooms, they're downstairs. You go down the stairs to your left, there's men and women. There's a small single washroom by the kitchen at the other side. Excuse me, exit. To my left, to my right, down the back, and to the side stairs as well. Parking, it looks like parking is full. If there are still a few individuals looking for spaces and we're full, your parking is available across the street on Moss Bank. So there's plenty of parking there. I think those are announcements. I just have one brief announcement for an event following the today. And also, Raphael, you want to just come and say a few words? This might be.
Hi everyone, thanks so much for coming. Since you're here, it probably means you have an interest in Muslim-Christian dialogue, getting to know each other, getting to know more about each other's faith. And we actually have an event that occurs once a month, technically twice a month, but it's the last Monday of the month, and it occurs here, 7:30, every single month. And we also have another event that occurs the Tuesday before that at 7:30, Tim Hortons on Birchmount and Ellesmere. So if you're interested in that, you can come to me and ask me, and I'll give you all the details. We'll also have a slide that has all the details there for you. So if you would like to continue the dialogue that we're having today, if there's questions that you have that you weren't able to get answered or even ask, please make sure that you show up to these. We have them every single month, and it's a great opportunity to get to know each other. So I hope to see many of you there. Thanks.
Okay, why don't we begin? Biography of Dr. Tony Costa. So Tony Costa has an earned BA and MA in the study of religion, biblical studies, and philosophy from the University of Toronto. Tony received his PhD in the area of theology and New Testament studies at Radboud University in the Netherlands. He is a member of the Society of Biblical Literature, the Evangelical Theological Society, and the Evangelical Philosophical Society. His area of expertise is biblical and systematic theology, cults, and New Age movement, and comparative world religions with a specialization in Islam. Tony is also an ordained minister of the gospel. As a Christian apologist, Dr. Acosta gives reasons for the valid beliefs in Christianity and advocates the unique claims of Jesus Christ. He is also a lecturer at various universities and colleges on the existence of God as well as the credibility of the Christian faith. Tony is also a professor of apologetics with Toronto Baptist Seminary. He also serves as an adjunct professor with Heritage College and Seminary in Cambridge, Ontario, and Providence Theological Seminary in Colorado Springs, Colorado. He has lectured and ministered throughout Canada, the United States, and overseas. Tony is happily married to his wonderful wife and three children and resides in Toronto, Canada. Please help me in welcoming Dr. Tony Costa.
Thank you very much, Gary, and thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for coming here tonight for this very important event on Can We Trust the Torah, or Can We Trust Today's Torah? So thank you again for giving up your Friday evening to be here with us tonight to share in this very important event. Let me just say something about the topic of the debate and the rules of the debate that had been mutually agreed upon by both parties. In terms of the outline of tonight's debate, each speaker is going to have introductory statements about, they're going to be 35 minutes in length each. And we will begin first with Mr. Sadat Anwar, followed by Mr. Alex Grimley. And then this will be followed by first rebuttals of 12 minutes each, and then second rebuttals of 5 minutes each. And then finally, each speaker will have their concluding remarks of 12 minutes each. In terms of the format as well, after the introductory statements from each of the speakers, there's going to be a 10-minute break. And we also encourage you to check some of the tables that we have. We have a table at the back, I believe there's two tables, that you can check out some information that is relevant to the topic tonight, or just information on both Christianity and Islam. So that's right at the back at the entrance to the church building. In terms of the debate format itself, we ask the audience please refrain from any forms of interruptions while the speakers are giving their lecture. Please withhold your applauses to the end. Hold your tucked beers and your hallelujahs to the very end if you can. And if you don't, we will ask you to kindly leave the building. Moreover, we also ask that if you have any cell phones with you, please turn them off. There's nothing more annoying than cell phones going off. And so this church, of course, we consider this a great sin. So if you could have your cell phones turned off. Some people have lost their lives as a result of that. No, I'm just kidding. Also, I'd like to take this opportunity to also introduce each of the speakers. Since Mr. Sadat Omar is going to be speaking first, I'd like to begin first by giving you his biography. Sadat was born and raised in Canada. Sadat is a Sunni Muslim. He's also a graduate of the University of Toronto with a master's degree in Middle Eastern Studies. Sadat has a keen interest in interfaith dialogue, especially between the three Abrahamic faiths. He is also a member of the Muslim Debate Initiative, MDI, an Islamic organization based in the United Kingdom. He's also active in Dawah, which is Muslim outreach, involved in activities in the Greater Toronto Area. Mr. Alex Primley. Alex was born in Azerbaijan. Alex was born and raised, actually, he was an atheist, and then became a Christian. He's an evangelical Christian, active in evangelism, and he is part of the Road to Christ Christian Ministry. So, without any further ado, I'm going to ask Mr. Sadat Anwar to come and to give his first opening statements in 35 minutes, and then we will have Mr. Alex Grimley. Can you please help me in welcoming Sadat Anwar?
The most merciful. First of all, I'd like to thank everyone here at Faith Baptist Church, especially Pastor Brian Robinson and Pastor Mr. Gary Thompson for hosting the debate, Mr. Tony Costa for moderating the debate, and of course Alex Karamli for the invitation to do the debate. Can we trust today's Torah? Today's Torah. It depends partly on what we mean by trust. There's people that I trust partly, but not fully. There are people whose judgment I trust, but I don't trust their memory. Or I trust their memory, and I don't trust their judgment. Similarly, there are books that I trust for historical information, but not necessarily for morals or for theology. And conversely, there are parables and fairy tales and stories that we can trust for good moral lessons, but not necessarily for history. The question for the purpose of our discussion here is whether we can trust today's Torah 100% as the inerrant word of God, without any errors and without any contradictions. Can we trust the Torah in that way? Can we trust the Torah in the way that Alex and evangelical Christians trust it? My answer to that question is no. Muslims do trust and believe in the original Holy Torah, which was revealed to the Prophet Moses by God on Mount Sinai. But we cannot fully trust the present-day Torah, or the so-called five books of Moses found in the modern Bible. Today's Torah is not the same Torah as the one that was revealed to the Prophet Moses 3,500 years ago. Today's Torah still does contain the words of God and his prophets, but it also includes the words of third-party scribes, priests, and redactors who have sometimes falsely attributed statements to God and his prophets. Now, before I get into the reasons why, there's two misconceptions that I quickly want to clarify. Both of these misconceptions can be found in what Alex has presented in the past, and he's called the Muslim Global Torah Change Conspiracy. Misconception number one is that Alex has said in the past that all Muslims believe that the Torah was changed after the time of the Prophet Muhammad. Fact, there is no one official sanctioned Islamic view on when, where, or how, or by whom the Torah was changed. The idea that the Torah was changed after the time of Muhammad is one strand of thought amongst many strands of thought. In other words, Alex has in the past committed a straw man fallacy. There are even some Quranic verses and hadiths that would imply or indicate that the Torah may have been changed before the time of the Prophet Muhammad that may come up in the rebuttals. Misconception number two is that by believing that the Torah has been changed, Muslims are engaging in a conspiracy theory. We are believing this conspiracy theory against all of the historical evidence, against the manuscript evidence, against the archaeological evidence. In short, Muslims are out in the cold, in complete opposition to the historical proof by believing that the Torah has been changed. Fact, the majority of Western academic scholars of the Torah today, including even the majority of Jewish and Christian scholars, believe that the Torah as we have it today was originally composed more than half a millennium after the time of the prophet Moses. What Islam teaches about the corruption of the Jewish and the Christian scriptures may have sounded like a conspiracy theory back in the 7th century, but in the 21st century there's a remarkable convergence between what the Quran and the Islamic tradition are saying about the previous scriptures and what modern scholarship of the Torah is saying. The idea that most of the Torah was composed after the time of Moses can be found in the Quran in chapter 2, verse 79. فَوَيْلُ الَّذِينَ يَكْتُبُونَ الْكِتَابَ بِأَيْدِهِمْ ثُمَّ يَقُولُونَ هَذَا مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ لِيَشْتَرُوا ثَمَنًا قَلِيلًا. The translation is that they write with their own hands. The preceding verses are talking about the Jews. Then it says they write with their own hands. Woe to those who write with their own hands and then say that this is from God in order to gain from it some miserable gain. How are modern-day scholars of the Torah, including even most Christian scholars, agreeing with this Quranic verse or with this Quranic allegation? Well, today one of the main theories on the authorship of the Torah adopted by Christians is called the documentary hypothesis. In a nutshell, modern-day scholars say that the Torah had four different strands of writing, four different writers or groups of writers wrote the modern-day Torah. They identify these strands as the J source, which was written around 950 BCE, the E source, or the Elohist source, which was written 100 years after that, the D source, or the Deuteronomist source, which was written around 600 BCE, and finally the P, or the Priestly source, which was written around 500 BCE. Take note of the dates, because if Moses lived between 1300 and 1500 BCE, and if the P source was composed, let's say, in 500 BCE, we're already close to 1,000 years after the time of Moses. The majority of biblical scholars today believe this. But is something true because the majority of people believe it? My answer is no. We should have our own good independent reasons for believing or for not believing in something. So now let's get into the main reasons. I'm going to present five reasons for why I think we cannot trust today's Torah and we should reject the idea of Mosaic authorship of today's Torah. Number one, there is no explicit claim of Mosaic authorship of all five books. Number two, transmission problems. Number three, canonization problems. Number four, contradictions. And number five, moral flaws. So let's explain number one. No explicit claim of authorship. This should be evident to anyone who even does a cursory or a superficial reading of the Torah. You'll see that nowhere in the Torah is there any claim that Moses wrote all five books. You won't find any claim that Moses wrote Genesis or that Moses wrote Exodus, for example. To the contrary, there are strong indications that these books were written by someone other than Moses and after the time of Moses. What are some of those indications or clues? Well, one example is the consistent use of the third-person narrative perspective. In most of the stories in Genesis and Exodus, you find the use of the third person. So, for example, Adam said to God, God said to Adam, Eve said to God, Moses said unto God, God said unto Moses. If it was God speaking, we would expect him to say that I said unto Moses. Or if Moses wrote it, we would expect him to say that I went up the mountain, I saw the burning bush, and God said to me. But we don't find that. So the use of the third person perspective. And by third person, I don't mean any one of the three persons of the Trinity. Clearly, it's not God the Father speaking, it's not God the Son speaking, it's not God the Holy Ghost speaking. It's some other third person human scribe or chronicler who is writing this. Just like if I said, John said to Tony. If I write, John said to Tony, you know that I'm not John and you know that I'm not Tony. The next clue is anachronisms. Anachronisms means details that do not fit in with the supposed time of writing. For example, right at the beginning of Deuteronomy 1:1. These are the words that Moses spoke to all of Israel beyond the Jordan. Now, if you remember, Moses never crossed the Jordan. So this is somebody who's already situated in the promised land, somebody who's already sitting in the land of Canaan saying, these are the words that Moses spoke back when he was on the other side of the Jordan. Just like, for example, if I say that beyond Niagara Falls is America, or across Niagara Falls is America, that only makes sense if we are situated here in Canada. That's the Canadian perspective. Another example is Genesis 12:6. At that time, the Canaanites were in the land. At that time means at Abraham's time. During Abraham's time, the Canaanites were in the land. But if Moses is writing Genesis, during Moses' time, the Canaanites were still in the land too. So there's no need for emphasis that at that time, the Canaanites were still in the land. Also, Deuteronomy chapter 34, verse 10. Not since has there arisen another prophet in Israel like Moses. That's not saying much if Moses is writing it. It only makes sense if a long time after the time of Moses, someone is saying that not since the time of Moses has there arisen another prophet as great as him. So these are some strong indications that make it pretty clear to me that the present day Torah is not the writing of Moses. The lack of an explicit claim of Mosaic authorship, coupled with the constant use of the third-person perspective and the many anachronisms, is probably what led the following person to say, "It is clearer than the sun at noon that the Pentateuch, the Torah, was not written by Moses, but by someone who lived long after Moses." Which Muslim said that? Baruch Spinoza, the 17th century Jewish philosopher. And now true, he wasn't a religious Jew, but the point is he wasn't a Muslim, and he's coming from the Judeo-Christian scholarly tradition. Let's move on to problem number two, transmission problems. There is a major problem pertaining to the transmission of the Torah. In other words, what is the history of this book and how did it get to us? Alex is probably, I think, going to bank much of his presentation on refuting the idea that the Torah was changed after the time of the Prophet Muhammad. But let's go farther back than where he might want us to look. Let's look at the big picture. Let's look at the trees. Let's not miss the trees for the forest or the forest for the trees. So what do we mean by transmission problems? Well, first of all, there's a 1,000-year missing link in the manuscripts. Alex likes talking about the Dead Sea Scrolls, but the Dead Sea Scrolls date from around 250 BCE. They were discovered in the Qumran caves in the late 1940s. It's one of the great ironies that God intended for two shepherds named Muhammad and Musa to begin these discoveries of the Dead Sea Scrolls. So Muhammad and Moses discovered the Dead Sea Scrolls. And amongst these discoveries, they discovered fragments of all five books of the Pentateuch. Very good. But the manuscripts that they found, as I said, date at the earliest from 250 BCE. If we consider that Moses lived around 1400 or 1300 BCE, then we have a gap in the manuscript tradition of over 1,000 years. In other words, we don't have manuscripts for the first 1,000 years of the existence of the Torah. So, you can do the math here. For example, if Moses lived around 1300 BCE, and the Dead Sea Scrolls are from 250 BCE, and even those are partial fragments, not the complete Pentateuch, you do the subtraction and you're left with over 1,000 years. So, I mean, if I was an evangelical Christian, or if I was Alex, honestly, I wouldn't want to bring up the issue of the Dead Sea Scrolls. Like, I really wouldn't want to bring up the issue of manuscripts. But we're not done discussing the transmission problems yet. The next problem is proven transmission breaks. Proven transmission breaks. It sounds like I'm talking about a car, but I'm talking about the Torah here. Transmission break number one happened sometime between the time of Moses himself and King Josiah, who lived around 600 BCE. Now, where did this conspiracy theory come from, that there was a break in the transmission? It comes from the Bible itself. In 2 Kings chapter 22, verse 8, it says, "And Helkiah the high priest said unto Shaphan the scribe, I have found the book of the Torah." In Hebrew it reads Torah, "in the house of the Lord. And it came to pass, when the king had heard the words of the book of the Torah, that he rent his clothes." He tore his clothes. Why did he do that? He didn't like his shirt. Why is he so worked up and tearing his clothes when he hears the book of the Torah? Obviously, it's because he had not seen this book of the Torah in a very, very long time. In fact, it tells you that pretty much in the next chapter in 2 Kings, chapter 23, verse 24. It says, Josiah put away the household gods and idols, all the abominations that were seen in the land of Judah and in Jerusalem, that he might perform the words of the Torah, which were written in the book that Hilkiah the priest found in the house of the Lord. He also did other reforms. He did away with unauthorized places of worship, altars for child sacrifice, and so forth. But my point is this. Isn't Josiah and isn't Hilkiah supposed to know this already? Is this not supposed to be in the Torah that they already had? That you don't worship false gods? You don't worship idols? You don't worship statues? You don't put idols of false gods in the temple? If the king and the high priest had ever read or heard of the book of Deuteronomy in their lives, they would have known this already, because in Deuteronomy chapter 12, verse 2, it says, "You shall utterly destroy all the places wherein the nations which you shall possess serve their gods, upon the high mountains and upon the hills and upon every green tree. And you shall overthrow their altars and break their pillars and burn their groves with fire. And you shall hew down the graven images of their gods and destroy the names of them out of that place." Isn't that Judaism 101? Isn't that like the Torah 101 or the Torah for dummies? You don't worship false gods. Why did they have to rediscover this lost book of the Torah to know that? Clearly, they had not seen the Torah in a very long time. Transmission break number two happened sometime between the time of King Josiah, whom we just mentioned, and the scribe Ezra, who came around 200 years later. Now, which Muslim is telling us this? Which atheist scholar is telling us this? The Bible is telling us this in the book of Nehemiah in chapter 8, verses 1 to 18. I'm going to start with verse 14, if you have it. "And they found written in the Torah, which the Lord had commanded by Moses, that the children of Israel should dwell in booths." Remember that. Children of Israel should dwell in booths in the feast of the seventh month. That's the festival of tabernacles, or the festival of booths. "And all the congregation of them that will come again out of the captivity made booths and sat under the booths. For since the days of Joshua the son of Nun, the children of Israel had not done so." But don't you think a Jewish priest and a scribe like Ezra should have known about this already? Whatever he had been a scribe of before, it obviously did not include important parts of the Torah, because the commandment to live in booths during the Festival of Tabernacles is found in the book of Leviticus. It's found in the Torah that, according to Alex, was never lost, never corrupted, never changed, never forgotten. But if Ezra and the high priest had ever read the book of Leviticus in their lives, they would have read Leviticus chapter 23, verse 42, where it says very clearly, "You shall dwell in booths 7 days. All that are Israelites born shall dwell in booths." It's talking about that same festival. Clearly, they had not seen the book of Leviticus in a very, very long time. Let's move on to the third main problem, which is canonization problem. Basically, this means different versions of the Torah. 3,500 years after the revelation of the Torah, the canonization of the Torah is still not really fully complete. There is still dispute over it. Today's Torah can mean at least 5 to 6 different Torahs. It can mean the Septuagint Torah, which is today's Torah for millions of Greek Orthodox and Eastern Orthodox speaking Christians. It can mean the Masoretic Torah, which is today's Torah for millions of English-speaking Protestant Christians. It can mean the Samaritan Torah, which is today's Torah for the tiny remnant of the northern Israelite tribes still worshipping at Mount Gerizim in northern Israel. It can mean the Peshitta Torah, which is today's Torah for the Syriac Christians. And it can mean even the Latin Vulgate Torah, which for centuries was today's Torah for most of your ancestors in Western Europe. That was the Torah that they read. Now, Alex might show you some passages from the Masoretic and the Septuagint text to show that there's not any differences or any real differences between the two. But I want to show you a few versions, a few verses which show the opposite. So, for example, if we read Genesis 5:31, but which Genesis 5:31 are we going to read from? Which Torah? If we read from the Septuagint, it says, "All the days of Lamech were 753, and he died." But in the Masoretic, it says, "All the days of Lamech were 777, and he died." And the Samaritan Torah says, "All the days of Lamech were 653 and he died." You might want to check your Bibles afterwards to see which version it is that yours says. Now clearly, this is not a problem of different translations, is it? This is a problem of different versions. Genesis 16:12. He, meaning Ishmael, shall be a wild man. Every evangelical Christian who ministers to Muslims knows this verse. In the Masoretic, it also says he shall be a wild man. It uses the Hebrew word perir. But in the Samaritan, it says he will be a fruitful man. The Hebrew word used is actually different, para. Similarly, there's Exodus 12:40, where it says the length of time the Israelite people lived in Egypt and Canaan was 430 years. But in the Masoretic, it says the length of time the Israelite people lived in Egypt, meaning Egypt only, was 430 years. And Samaritan, I believe, agrees with the Septuagint. Now, for those who say this doesn't make any difference, it makes a difference. If Tony told me I have 10 minutes to do the rebuttals, versus Tony telling me I have 10 minutes to do the rebuttals and the conclusion, that makes a big difference to me. So these are some of the problematic issues that have to do with different versions, not translations, different versions of the Torah, that led the scholar Howard Cox to say, when asked what a passage of the Bible says, in many cases the honest answer is that one tradition says one thing and another tradition says something else. Now, before I make any more comments on any other versions of the Torah, I just wanted to quickly ask Alex, is this your book that you authored, is it?
I give it away.
Yeah, but you didn't author this? You didn't author this book?
I
didn't. Yeah, because I've come across a website that where it mentions Alex Kernley and Amy Ben-Khanan, so I'm a bit confused. Are you also one of the authors? Okay, thank you. So, just moving on then, the reason I want to bring this up is because in addition to these 5-6 different versions of the Torah, I have found another version of the Torah, which I'm going to call the Alexan Torah, because I've named it after Alex. And we don't have any manuscript proof for it, but we can sort of reconstruct it from the references or the citations that Alex gives in his book. So, for example, on page 253 of his book, he says, there is no command anywhere in the Bible to kill those who do not want to believe. There is no command anywhere in the Bible to kill those who do not want to believe. Rather, there is the commandment to leave them alone. So what I gather from this is that Alex's Torah is quite different from the versions of the Torah that I have read. So, for example, in the Masoretic and in the Septuagint, in Exodus chapter 31, verse 15, it says, anyone who does work on the Sabbath is to be put to death. But the Alexan Torah, I think, says anyone who does work on the Sabbath is to be left alone. Deuteronomy chapter 13, verses 6 to 10. If your brother, the son of your mother, or your son entices you secretly, saying, let us go and serve other gods, you shall surely kill him. That's what it says in the Torahs that we probably read. But in the Alexan Torah, it says, if your brother, the son of your mother, or your son entices you secretly, saying, let us go and serve other gods, you shall surely leave him alone. It's a different Torah, and not a trustworthy one either, I don't think. Let's move on to number 4, contradictions. Even if we determine which Torah is correct, which one of these versions is correct, what do we do with the problems of contradictions within the text? In the Quran, God says, do they not consider the Quran with care? Had it been from anyone other than God, they would have found therein much discrepancy, many contradictions. This is a polite hint in the Quran of how God wants us to approach not only the present-day Torah, but any book which is claiming to be from God. Now, to be honest, as soon as you get into the Torah, you basically get past 2 or 3 pages of Genesis and you run smack into contradictions. So, for example, right in Genesis 1, were the humans created first or were the animals created first? According to Genesis 1:26, the animals are created first. According to Genesis 2:7, Adam, human beings, are created first. This is why the documentary hypothesis says there's different strands of the Torah, different versions of the Torah. Example number 2, will Jacob be called Jacob anymore? In Genesis 32:28, God says to Jacob, your name shall be called no more Jacob, but Israel. But then later on in Genesis 46:2, God himself calls Jacob, saying, Jacob, Jacob. Example 3, was the name Yahweh known before the time of Moses? The answer according to Exodus 6:2 is no. Because God says, I appeared unto Abraham and Isaac and unto Jacob by the name of God Almighty, but by name Yahweh was I not known to them. But in Genesis 4:1, that's earlier on, Eve uses the name Yahweh and says, I have conceived a man or I have gotten a man from Yahweh. Which passage of the Torah is trustworthy here? Example number 4 is, how old was Ishmael when he left Abraham? Everyone agrees that by the time of Genesis 21, Ishmael has to have been a teenager. Minimum 13, 14, 15 years old. But in verse 14 of Genesis 21, it says, Abraham gave some items to Hagar, putting it on her shoulder along with the child. The Septuagint is even more clear. The Septuagint version says, he put the child on her shoulder. How do you put a 13, 14, 15-year-old kid on her shoulder? In verse 15, when the water in the skin was gone, she cast the child under one of the bushes. Like, the picture that's painted is very much of a very small Ishmael who can't fend for himself at all. Verse 17, God speaks to Hagar, not to Ishmael, even though Ishmael's the one that was crying. Verse 18, God tells Hagar, arise, lift up the lad, and hold him in your hand. It's not an appropriate thing to say to a woman who's thirsty in the desert, pick up your 14-year-old kid in your hand. Example number 5, Joseph's dream from God. Was it fulfilled or was it unfulfilled? In Genesis 37:9, it says that Joseph had a dream, and he told it to his brothers. Listen, he said, I've had a dream, and this time the sun and the moon and the 11 stars were bowing down to me. Obviously, the 11 stars are Joseph's 11 brothers, and the sun and the moon must be who? It must be his parents, Jacob and his mother, Rachel. The problem is that earlier on in Genesis 35:19, it says Rachel died. So the prophecy is not fulfilled. The sun and the moon never submitted to him because the moon, being his mother Rachel, had already died. In the Quran, on the other hand, in the Quran in chapter Yusuf or chapter Joseph, it says in verse 4, Yusuf said to his father, O my father, I have seen 11 stars and the sun and the moon prostrating to me. It sounds like a copy of the Torah, right? But the ending is different because in verse 100, it says, and he raised his parents upon the throne, and they bowed to him in prostration. And he said, O my father, this is the explanation of my vision of before. My Lord has made it a reality. And incidentally, in the same chapter at the very end, it says, there was certainly in their stories a lesson for those of understanding. Never was the Quran a narration invented, but rather it is a confirmation of what was before it and a detailed explanation of all things and a guidance and a mercy for a people who believe. Example number 6, the universal flood. Was there a universal flood that destroyed all life? According to Genesis 17, there was. A flood of waters upon the earth to destroy all flesh, it says, wherein is the breath of life from under heaven, and everything that is in the earth shall die. Everything on the earth under the heaven is going to perish, is going to be destroyed in the flood. Genesis 7:4 says the same thing. Every living substance that I have made, will I destroy all from the face of the earth? And in Genesis 8:9, it confirms the waters were on the face of the whole earth. Not part of the earth, not the Near East, not Mesopotamia, the whole earth. The problem with that is that we have archaeological evidence of ancient civilizations that were not just in existence, but flourishing during the time that Noah's flood is supposed to have occurred. For example, the Old Kingdom in ancient Egypt. That's actually called the Age of the Pyramids because the construction was going on. And there is Harappa, which I wanted to mention, and this is in modern-day Pakistan. And similarly, this civilization was flourishing at the very time that Noah's flood is supposed to have occurred. So much so that it's called the mature Harappan phase. So basically, the idea of a universal flood in the 25th century BCE, or thereabouts, does not hold water, pun intended. The Quran mentions Noah's flood, but it does not so explicitly spell out that it was a universal flood, so it could have been a regional flood. Nor does the Quran mention the part about God putting a rainbow in the sky to remind himself that he's not going to send another flood again, and so forth. Example number 7. Ancient Egypt loses its entire labor workforce. According to Exodus 12, the number of Israelites who came out of Egypt was 600,000. If 600,000 men. If 600,000 men came out of Egypt during the Exodus, that would mean at least about 2 million people in total, because they have wives, they have children, and we're not counting the cattle and all that. But the problem with that is, again, that there's absolutely no evidence. Like Egypt, there's no ancient Egyptian records that would mention that 2 million of our people just disappeared. You know, they just left. What happened to the economy of ancient Egypt? Why don't we find any settlements out in the desert where these 2 million people encamped? How would Moses even wake up 2 million people in the middle of the night and mobilize them towards the Red Sea without anybody taking note? In the Quran, in chapter 26, verses 52 to 54, the Pharaoh, very interestingly, the Pharaoh actually dismisses the Israelites and says they're a small band of troublemakers. They're just a small group of mischief makers. And this is very much in line with what modern-day scholarship is saying, which is that if there was an Exodus, it couldn't have happened on the mass proportions as it's reported in the book of Exodus. Number five is moral flaws, what I identify to be as moral flaws. You might have a different moral compass than me. It's a subjective thing. That's fine. If I have time, I want to discuss some of these, which is that there's Eve's double punishment. For example, in Genesis chapter 3, verse 16, to the woman, to Eve, God says, I will greatly increase your pangs in childbearing. In pain you shall bring forth children, yet your desire shall be for your husband, and he shall rule over you. Has he proven himself worthy of ruling over her? If he just went along with her suggestion, would be a question. But it doesn't seem fair to me. It seems like a double punishment. Every woman here will suffer from the pains of childbirth when she has children, whereas men will not suffer that. Men will not suffer that. And you see a similar thing going on with Miriam's punishment in Numbers chapter 12. Miriam and Aaron, both of them, Miriam and Aaron spoke against Moses because of the Ethiopian woman whom he had married. But then in verse 10 it says, the cloud departed from off the tabernacle, and behold, Miriam became leprous. She had leprosy or a skin disease as a punishment. And Aaron looked upon Miriam, and behold, she was leprous. Again, the point is, Miriam and Aaron spoke out against Moses, criticized Moses. God only punishes Miriam. He doesn't punish Aaron. This strikes me as being a moral flaw. What about Miriam, your rapist, in Deuteronomy chapter 22, verse 29? If a man finds a girl that is a virgin who is not married and lays hold on to her and lies with her and they be found, then the man that lay with her shall give unto the girl's father 50 shekels of silver, and she shall be his wife because he has humbled her. He may not put her away, meaning he may not divorce her for the rest of the days of his life. I'm not suggesting that there's an evil intent behind this law. The intent here is probably a deterrent so that men will not rape women, otherwise you sort of get stuck with her. There's probably good intention behind the law. But is it a perfect law? Is it a holy law that you would expect to come from God? I don't believe it is. And it mentions nothing about the consent of the woman. What if she doesn't want to marry her rapist? And this would solve a lot of problems for a lot of love-stricken kids in high school. The guy's in love with the girl, rape her, you get to marry her. This strikes me as being a moral flaw. What about ritual uncleanliness after female childbirth in Leviticus 12? To summarize, after the birth of a baby boy, the woman is ritually impure for a total of 40 days. But after the birth of a baby girl, the woman is ritually impure for a total of 80 days. So she's ritually impure for double the amount. Why? Another aspect of what I consider to be moral flaws is the moral depravity of the prophets of God. Just like we Muslims have a problem with Jesus being elevated to the level of God, we have a problem with David, Lot, Noah, Moses being reduced down to the level of sinners. And not even sinners like us. Much, much worse, doing much worse things. So for example, Noah gets naked, he gets drunk, and he gets naked, and he's lying around naked. Many Westerners will say, no big deal, I've done that or something. But for Muslims, this is unthinkable that a prophet of God does that. Moreover, what about the prophet Lot, who doesn't just get naked, but he commits incest with his own daughters? Is that befitting, or is that what you would expect from a prophet of God? And would anyone want to read those passages here to their daughters? If I had a daughter in the audience, honestly, I wouldn't want to bring up that passage at all. What about Moses commanding the targeted killing of innocent non-combatant women and children in the book of Numbers? In the book of Numbers, chapter 31, verse 17, Moses commands the Israelites, now therefore kill every male among the little ones, all the little boys kill them, and kill every woman that has known man by lying with him, but all the girls or all the women children that have not known man by lying with him, keep alive for yourselves. So all the babies are to be killed, and all the women who are not virgins are to be killed. And that presumably would include pregnant women as well. The pregnant women and the unborn children are also to be killed. I don't believe that any prophet of God ever target killed civilian women and children like this. So in summary, these are some very good reasons, I believe. And these reasons are not limited to Islam or to the Quran or to a Muslim perspective. These are good reasons to doubt the Mosaic authorship of today's Torah, and therefore to doubt its continuing divine status. I hope that Alex will address at least some of these points in his presentation and not just give us a rehash of that straw man argument, the global Torah change conspiracy, which doesn't take into account the possibility of the Torah having been changed before the time of the Prophet Muhammad. He only addresses the possibility of the Torah having been changed after the time of Prophet Muhammad. Clearly, there are a host of larger problems that exist in the transmission and the canonization of the Torah centuries before the time of Muhammad, and even centuries before the time of Jesus. I hope Alex will respond to these problems and give us clear and convincing proofs for why we should trust and believe in the present-day Torah. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sadat. And at this point, I'd like to invite Alex Trimley to come and give us 35 minutes. Alex also asked me to inform you that English is not his first language, so if his English seems a little broken, that's because it is. Help me in welcoming Alex Trimley tonight.
First, I'd like to speak about terminology here. First of all, the Quran. The Quran is a word that came from God, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, directly without involving any of the Muhammad's word is based on him. The Hadith is, on the contrary, the words of the Muhammad and these of Muhammad is based on him. And the Sirah Rasulullah is that they also. The biography of Muhammad is upon him.
I can't hear your words very clearly.
Can you hear me well?
Let's switch to the other mic.
Another mic?
Yeah.
Okay.
Can I hear like a little background noise?
Okay. Now?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. So I restart again. Okay. So the Torah is five books of Moses, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. Tanakh is Old Testament, including five books of Moses in the first part of it. So I have to make a first statement. Statement is like, I do accept the claim of modern Muslims about that the Quran we have right now, as I have it right here, is the same one what Muhammad, peace be upon him, used to recite, made by three logical, for me, evidence. First of all the Qurans we have in Arabic today are similar or the same. All ancient manuscripts of the Quran today as well, they are the same. And what's most important is that we don't have any other version of the Quran as old as like Topkapi manuscript or Samarkand manuscript. It's very different from the Quran we have right now. Well, after saying that, I have to make a disclaimer. I do well aware of the fact that we have two different Qurans in Arabic right now, which are the Hafs and Warsh manuscript, that are existing right now and today. We have 1,354 differences among them. But also, we have textual problems within the top captain Samarkand Museum and some copies of the Quran, and they are not 100% agreeing with each other, as well as they're not 100% agreeing with the Qurans we have right now in Arabic. But I see that differences are minor, they're not really, how to say, threaten any of the story narration from the Qurans we have right now, and they're not really going against any of the Quranical topic. So therefore, I consider these differences are minor, and I think the Qurans we have right now, and the Quran that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, used to recite, is they are extremely similar, and therefore, as I said, I accept the claim of all the Muslims that the Quran, what we have right now in Arabic, it's virtually the same with the Quran that Muhammad, peace be upon him, he used to recite. Okay, now we can start the presentation. Can we trust this Torah? And I believe that's the most important question we could address as we debate between Muslim and Christians. Because if you start reading the book from, you start reading any book from the beginning to the end, so therefore we're not going to start reading the book of the Bible from Matthew, Mark, Luke or John, we start reading the book from Genesis. So therefore the Torah, I mean, is usually found in Hebrew language, in the script, in the scroll. Like, Torah for all known history is written in Hebrew by hand, but of course we have many versions of the Torah, sorry, not the versions, but I mean the books, and there's a book format. Like this one I do have, it's a Tanakh, it's entire Old Testament. So the Torah, it means basically in law, direction and instruction. And it's found in 213 verses of the Old Testament. So now, how can I read and understand the Torah as a Christian? Well, I have three choices. First of all, I have my personal opinion. So I can read the Torah stories, and I could look through the lens of 21st century person. I said, well, this story doesn't make sense, or I agree with that story, etc. from the Torah, right? So, second, I could use opinion of other people. Let's say I can go to the liberal or political scholars of the past centuries, like Wellhausen, for example. Or I can go to the modern liberal scholar, like Bardevnum. Or even I can go extreme and to hear what Richard Dawkins, the atheist, will speak. For sure, he will have something good to speak about the existence of God, any God, Allah or Yahweh. But I can also use the New Testament as my reference point. Now, if I claim myself to be Christian, it means that the highest authority will be on the New Testament and everything will be irrelevant. So therefore, let us read from New Testament. And I have a first claim to make. The New Testament confirms the divine origin of the Torah in the first century AD. So let's start. The law and the prophets found 6 times in the New Testament. The scripture, 31 times, as it is written, 34 times, fulfilled 57 times, the law, 137 times. And every time you find it, it's always speaking in a positive sense, it's confirming the Torah as a scroll during the time of Christ. So here I show you only 3 verses. Jesus speaking, "For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law, till all be fulfilled." Then we hear Peter speaking, "And now, brethren, I know that in ignorance you did crucify Jesus, as did also your rulers. But the things which God foreshown by the mouth of all prophets, that his Christ should suffer, he does fulfill." And now we have Paul speaking, "All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness." Again, it's speaking about all scripture, all the Torah. So we have Paul, Peter, and Jesus speaking and endorsing the Torah in the days of their walking on the working on the earth. So conclusion is the New Testament confirms the divine origin of the Torah in the first century AD. Now what about Muslims? How they will look at it? Well, any Muslim will have also three options. The first, personal opinion. So you can read Torah's story of Genesis and think, well, it doesn't make sense, it makes sense to me. Then you can use opinion of others and see like what again liberal scholars want to say about the Torah. Or you can go as far as listen to the Muslim debaters and presenters, Ahmed Dalzak and Naik Yusuf Esther. And also you can go to the Quran, the Hadith, and see Rasulullah. Now, if a person claims to be Muslim, I expect from him to believe that the high authority for the Muslim, it should be the Quran, the Hadith, and see Rasulullah, and everything else, it goes, like, became irrelevant. So now I have to make my second claim that the Quran and Muhammad, peace be upon him, confirm the divine origin of the Torah in 7th century AD or 3rd century of Hijra. Okay, this Quranic verse. O people of scripture, Jews and Christians, now has come to you our messenger Muhammad, explaining to you much of that which you used to hide from the scripture and pass over much, leaving out without explanation. That's very interesting. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying in this specific verse of the Quran, and he's addressing to the Jews and said, look, what people of scripture, Jews, in that particular subject, now has come to you, not to your ancestors, 1,000 years before, 2,000 years before, our messenger Muhammad, peace be upon him, explaining to you much, since meaning a lot, of which you used to hide from scripture and pass over much. Link with that explanation. Meaning, definition is, if Jews were already changing the Torah for centuries, why they should hide anything from the Torah? They will actually bring it and present to the people. So look, it's our immoral behaviors are supported by our new revision of the Torah. Okay? But in that case, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, well, you hide from the scripture because you cannot change it. And here's a perfect example from Sahih Bukhari, the Hadith. A Jew and the Jews were brought to Allah's Apostle on charge of committing an illegal sexual intercourse. The Prophet asked them, what is the legal punishment for this sin in your book, Torah? They replied, our priests have innovated the punishment of blackening their faces with charcoal like tajbiyah. Abdullah bin Salam said, Allah's Apostle, tell them to bring the Torah. The Torah was brought, and then one of the Jews put his hand over the divine verse of Rajab, stoning to death, and started reading what preceded and what followed it. On that, Ibn Salam said to the Jew, lift up your hand. Behold, the divine verse of Rajab was under his hand. So it's exactly what the Quran said. You hide from the scripture. These words, caused two people to die that day. And if Jews were so uncomfortable to have this verse against them, why they didn't simply change it? It's logical. You change it and then you have no problem. Nobody can accuse you of anything, right? But it was not changed. It was hidden. And the previous verse from the Quran that said, you hide much, you hide a lot, meaning a lot of stuff is going against you and you have no choice. You cannot change it by definition. So what do? You hide a lot. Let's go to Sirah Rasulullah, which is biography of Muhammad. In chapter 9, the Qibla said, once Mark asked some Jewish rabbis about the subject mentioned in the Torah, but they refused to answer him about it. So Allah revealed the verse, those who conceal what we have sent down after we have made it plain will be cursed by Allah. You see the word conceal? It's not, he didn't say, well, those who changed the word, those who corrupted it. No, he said you conceal, you hide it. How did they hide it? Simply by refusing to talk about the subject. Let's go next one. On another occasion, the apostle entered the Jewish school and invited those who were present to Allah. They asked, what is your religion, Muhammad? And he replied, the religion of Abraham. They said, Abraham was a Jew. But the apostle told them, bring the Torah and let that judge between me and you. But they, what? Refused. So again, Muhammad, peace be upon him, had no problem to say, well, let Torah judge between me and you. Why the Jews, if they were accustomed to change Torah so many times, so for centuries, why won't they say, hey, Muhammad, you know what? Come tomorrow. And we're going to find it. It's a problem to write, Abraham was a Jew, anywhere in the Torah, and then read it in front of Muhammad, peace be upon him. No problem. But they refused to do it because they know they have no power or authority or even desire to change the Torah, because that's capital sin. I'll go to the Quran. The likeness of those who were charged with the Torah when they did not observe it is as a likeness of an ass bearing books. Well, the question is, what's the problem? Who is the problem here in this application? The books corrupted, or an animal who has no profit, who is of bearing books, and there is nothing good coming from the animal. You have to know what's there, and you have to observe it. Not only have it, not only read it, but observe it. Here's another Quranic verse. All food was lawful to the children of Israel, except that which Israel had forbidden to himself before the Torah was revealed. Say, bring present tense the Torah and read it present tense, if you are truthful. So here, the last one that I said to Muhammad, peace be upon him. Look, if Jews come to you and say, you know what, we're not supposed to eat camel's meat, or we're not supposed to drink camel's milk. Don't believe them until they bring the Torah and read it. If it's written there, then they are truthful. Otherwise, they're liars. And if thou, Muhammad, are in doubt concerning that which we reveal unto thee, then question those who do what? Who read, again, present tense, the scripture that was before thee. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in his knowledge and foreknowledge and all knowledge, he said, you know what, Muhammad, go, if you don't sure if I send you, so go across the street to that synagogue with the Jewish people sitting and reading the Torah, and they will tell you the truth because they have my Torah unchanged. Say, O Muhammad, people of the scripture, Jews and Christians, you have nothing as regard guidance till you act according to the Torah and Injil, and what has been sent down to you from your Lord, the Quran. Well, that's interesting. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the Jews and Christians that they have nothing as regard the guidance till you not only have, not only read, but to act, observe, and act according to the Torah, number one, Injil, Gospel, number two, and the Quran, number three. You see the one shelf and authority. All three books are on the one shelf of authority. If you try to bring the Torah down, you will bring the Quran down with it. But what about this verse? Very famous. Then woe to those who write the book, the Torah, with their own hands, and then say, this is from Allah, traffic with it for miserable price. First of all, I said, well, if the Muslim said, well, it's about changing the Torah, I said, well, first of all, it's about writing the book, not changing. The word write is not the word change. But we have to read verse above it. And there among them, among whom? Of course, like the Quran as the Bible, speaking about two groups of people, the true believers and non-believers. So here, it said, and there among them illiterate. So among the Jewish believers, there are a group of people who are illiterate, or I should say ignorant, who know not the book, the Torah, but see their own desires, and they do nothing by conjecture. And let's read both verses together. And there among them illiterates, who don't know the book, then woe to those who write the book. So the same group of people who don't know the book, or write another book, or corrupt the existing book. Well, I have to tell you, if you don't know the book, if I don't know the Hebrew, how can I corrupt the Hebrew? So for a person to corrupt, to have ability to corrupt the text, you have to know the text thoroughly. But here, for sure, these people who are illiterate or ignorant, they don't know the Torah, they write a book. And the proper thing is it should be another book. Well, let's go 10 verses down and see. And there comes to them, Jews, a book from Allah, the Quran, the confirming what is with them. When? Confirming what is with them during the days of Muhammad, peace be upon him. Let's go up several verses and here again. O children of Israel, believe in that what I have sent down, this Quran, confirming that which is with you, the Torah and Injil, Gospel. Well, let's read them all together. Let's put them on the screen. So my question is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, I sent the Quran down to confirm which book? The book of 78 or the book of 79 verse? Well, I believe that's the book of 78. Okay, therefore, whatever it is with the Jews, it's book, which is verse 78, the Torah. It means, at least, the true Torah was existed at the time when it was another book was came along, and it's not really from God. Okay? So the Torah must be reliable in the days of Muhammad, peace be upon him. Then another one. Or you have been given the scripture, Jews and Christians, believe in what we have revealed to Muhammad, peace be upon him, confirming what is already with you. And here's another one. But how do they, Jews, come to you, Muhammad, for decision? Well, they have, present tense, the Torah, in which is, present tense, the plain decision of Allah. Yet even after that, they turn away, for they are not really believers. So again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala complained to Muhammad, peace be upon him, and said, look, how come those Jews that keep coming to you again and again and bother you? Well, they have a Torah in which is plain decision of God. But they come to you to confirm it. Let's go to Sunan Abu Dawud. There's another hadith. A group of Jews came and invited the Apostle of Allah to Kuf. So he visited them in their school. They said, Abu Qasim, one of our men has committed fornication with a woman, so pronounce judgment upon them. They placed a cushion for Apostle of Allah, who sat on it and said, bring the Torah. It was then brought. He then withdrew the cushion from beneath him and placed the Torah on it, saying, I believe in thee and in him who revealed thee. Now we're talking about the scroll, complete scroll Torah from Genesis to Deuteronomy. He didn't say, well, I believe in parts of it, I believe in some part, I didn't believe in some. He said, you know what he did actually? Well, first of all, some Muslims said, well, you know what, we don't believe he said it. Probably this Islamic source was corrupted by bad Muslims. Well, I said, okay, maybe he didn't say that. I believe in thee and in him who revealed thee, pointing to the Torah scroll. But what he did, he was sitting on a cushion, and then the Torah was brought, he even withdrew the cushion from beneath him and placed the Torah on it, and let's say, and he said something else. But it's fine. Whatever he did is actually he brought the Torah scroll the higher than he was sitting. So he regards it as a true, trustworthy word of God. Therefore, conclusion is the Quran and Muhammad, peace be upon him, confirmed the divine origin of the Torah in 7th century AD. Okay? But you might say, well, I don't believe that. Because first of all, I don't believe the New Testament, and I don't believe your explanation of the Quran and the Hadith. That's fine. Then I have another one for you, which is, yes, that's the scrolls. Archaeological discoveries of the last century confirmed that the Torah has never been changed during the last 2,129 years. And here's a Dead Sea Scrolls, I think I found of millennium. And I have in my hands here this booklet that I purchased in the Royal Ontario Museum in 2009. Okay? I want to show you page 18 what's written. So it speaks about this Genesis, and it said, it's date 125 to 100 before Christ. And it's 20 copies of Genesis being discovered. And let me read a few important information from there. Dating from around 250 before Common Era to to 68 Common Era. The scrolls include some 207 biblical manuscripts representing nearly all the books of the Hebrew Bible, Christian Old Testament, except the Book of Esther. Some of the biblical Dead Sea Scrolls are almost 1,000 years older than the next oldest known copies of the Hebrew Bible. And that's what's important part is here. The copies of Genesis among the Dead Sea Scrolls are extremely similar to a traditional Hebrew text. What does it mean? Let's have a chart here. So we have a Torah in every synagogue here as a scroll, and here as a book in front and outside of me. And Dead Sea Scrolls, apart more than 2,000 years. And everything what we have in between, all the copies archaeologically discovered and kept in a museum or in private possessions, they are almost identical. I should say they are extremely similar, and they are virtually the same. And then the New Testament came later, and then Quran came much later. And yet both books confirm that the Torah was divine in their time. And of course, we have different manuscripts, as Sadat showed us before. So we have at least Septuagint, found in 2nd century BC partially and 4th century AD complete version. And of course we have on the 5th century Syriac Peshitta on the bottom and Latin Vulgate on the top. So, and they are all similar. The stories are the same, nothing changed. So this, I have to make a statement now. Then I believe the Torah has never been changed for over 2,000 years because three facts. All the Torahs in Hebrew, in all the synagogues on the planet, in all books, are the same. Second, all the old manuscripts of the Torah are extremely similar, or I should say virtually the same. And yet, the most important, I don't have any other book, ancient scroll of the Torah, which is completely different from the manuscript we have. So, well, you might say, well, you know what, I don't believe that, and so that gives a lot of explanations why he will not believe the Torah. Then I have to bring, of course, the global Torah change conspiracy. But this conspiracy is basically the Muslims blame Jews and Christians to have this conspiracy, not the other way around. So the question is, when was it changed, the Torah? Before Jesus, between Jesus and Muhammad, or after Muhammad, peace be upon him? So, let me see. And that implies that we have annual Torah change contest going on for centuries, and the Jews will say, well, let's come together once in a while and write a new Torah, or a new some additional, something we have to change it. And eventually have a good sign, like, change Torah with us, let's do it. Well, maybe. Then this will be interesting to read, for example, well, the Jews come to two Jewish people come and start talking. Shalom. Hi. Manishma, how are you doing? Do you have something to do next year? Oh, Shalom Yehuda. No, nothing at all. Why don't you rewrite the Torah with my corruption in it? Oh, Baruch Hashem, let God be praised. What's a great idea. May I start today? Sure. But let me adulterate a few more stories about Moses. You'll have them after lunch. Shalom. But then I have a second question, the part of the first one. When do you think the Torah stopped being changed? This is the most important one. And then, what was changed? So let's address the first topic. When was it changed? So, I have to admit, I find the website, the Muslim website, an article by Bassam Zawari, who brought 37 points and proof, so to speak, from Islamic sources, the Torah was changed. Well, I have to bring only a few because I'm running out of time, unfortunately. And here is a companion of Muhammad, peace be upon him, Ibn Abbas. He said, the kings after the time of Jesus, son of Mary, substituted the Torah and Gospel, and there used to be amongst them believers who were reading the Torah, etc. I have to skip it. So the kings summoned them and gathered them together. He proposed either death to them or that they leave the recitation of the Torah and the Gospel, except what they substituted in place of it. Okay? So let's see what Vasant Zawadi wants to say about it. So here we see that Ibn Abbas talks about how the kings of the past used to force people to switch to the corrupted version of the scripture, clearly indicating that the scriptures contained writings which were false. Thus, the scriptures that the masses were using were textually corrupted. Since the kings forced the people to switch to the scripture or had them killed, this meant that the true uncorrupt scripture became lost or possibly remained safe with a very few number of people. But it seems clear that the corrupted corpus were distributed more widely. So we have at least time frame when it was changed. And it should be between Jesus and Muhammad, peace be upon him. But let's read another one. Uthman ibn Affan, also companion Muhammad, saying, because the Jews distorted the Torah, they added to it what they liked, and they erased from it what they hated, and they erased the name of Muhammad, peace be upon him, from the Torah, and for that Allah became angry. So this could happen only after the Muhammad, peace be upon him. Then what was changed? Let's go back to the first claim of Ibn Abbas. He said, the kings after the time of Jesus substituted the Torah. Twice he said it. But we don't know what exactly they substituted. So I'm just guessing, maybe it was, 15 commandments? Okay? And then, I don't know, maybe they don't like 5 and they brought down to 10. You never know. Well, Sir Rasulullah, let's go and read another, from biography of Muhammad, peace be upon him. So it said, on another occasion, the Apostle of Allah wrote to the Jews of Khaybar in this manner, in the name of Allah, the merciful, the compassionate. This is from Muhammad, Apostle of Allah, friend and brother of Moses, who confirms the revelation which Moses brought. Verily, Allah say to you, men of the scripture, and you will find it in your scripture, in the days of Muhammad, peace be upon him, in the Khaybar. Let's read what we should find in the Torah. Who would start? Muhammad is apostle of Allah. Those with him are violent against unbelievers, but merciful to one another. You can see them kneeling or prostrated, suing for the bounty and approbation of Allah. Their foreheads are marked by the traces of that prostration. Allah promises to those who believe and do good work, forgiveness and a great reward. Well, at least now we know exactly what we're missing in today's Torah. But let's move forward a little bit. Before that, I have to remind our Christian Muslim friends about the story of creation, and it's found in Genesis. The name of Genesis, baby sheep, in the beginning. So we have the first two verses, Genesis 1:1 and Genesis 1:2. It said, in the beginning God created the heaven and earth, etc. And then we have, let's go to the statement of early Muslims. Now, again from the same website, it said, evidence from a statement of Ka'b al-Akbar, who died 636 AD. Ka'b al-Akbar was a prominent rabbi who converted to Islam some years after the Prophet died. He is reported to have said in an authentic narration, what he said, the first line of the Torah says, Genesis 1:1, first line of the Torah, Muhammad is a messenger of Allah and my chosen slave. Verily, he is neither rude nor harsh, and he is a man who would not yell or scream in markets, and he will never award an ill deed with an ill deed. On the contrary, he will always award ill deed with a forgiveness. His birth will take place in Mecca, and his immigration will be Taibar, and his dominion will be in Sham. Well, it's not the end of it. We have a second line of the Torah, according to this guy, and it said, well, you might guess it now, I guess, right? Muhammad is a messenger of Allah, his nation are constantly praising, they praise Allah, etc. Well, let's see what Bassam wants to say about it. Here we see that Ka'b ibn al-Akbar is giving descriptions of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, from the Torah that we cannot find in today's Bible. And he is completely right. We cannot find this in today's Bible. Well, the possible logical explanation, conclusion from that statement is the description was removed and something else was added to fill the void. So, what has been changed in the Torah? At least we know it. His description of Muhammad, peace be upon him. So we have technical aspect to look at it. Supposedly you're right. And description of Muhammad, peace be upon him, was removed. And it must be done only after the Muhammad, peace be upon him. So then, Torah was unchanged, at least in a connection with the Muhammad, peace be upon him, until 622 AD. It means that Jews changed it after meeting Muhammad. And the Jews of Al Yathrib completely rewrite the Torah, and it takes you 1.5 years to rewrite the scroll from the beginning. After being expelled, they brought this corrupted Torah to other Jewish community, and they eventually convinced all other Jews of Novgorod to rewrite every existing Torah. Now I have to show the map of the Roman Empire at that time. The Jews were already dispersed for centuries. And do you think how many Jewish synagogues were in that, on this place? Thousands? Now guess what, you have to ride donkey, walk by foot or by horse or whatever, and you have to bring it to every single Jewish community. And not only that, it's hard to do it, but you have to convince everybody. And everybody will say, yes, I agree with you. Well, do you see that two Jews agree with about anything? And I haven't. Well, that's not the end of it. In order to complete the job, Jews should convince all Christians to apply the same change in their Bible in the Torah section. Well, I have to remind you, how many Christians' Bible do we have? Latin, Vulgate, Syriac, Peshitta, Coptic Bibles, Armenian Bible, Byzantine text, thousands of manuscripts altogether. We can see them in the museums, etc. So again, situation is, let's look at the map and think about it. How, like, we have thousands upon thousands of Christian communities, churches, monasteries, whatever, and they have the Bible in it. So now, Jews, after the changing, finishing the job of all Jewish communities, they have to knock the doors of every church or big community, say, hi, hello, my friend, Bishop, could you please change the Torah? And everybody said, sure, no problem, let's do it. And they have to compile together and read together and change together. So we have two problems with technical aspect. So Jews should change all the Torahs in their possession. Then they have to convince all the Christians to change the Torahs. But most important, they have to have, can you imagine that this conspiracy must be going on? And they have to really leave some kind of note. At least Muslim sources should say, you know what? We heard somebody saying to another guy, let's remove name of Muhammad from the Torah, and somebody said, no, I became God. Okay.
Thank you very much, Mr. Krimley. Folks, at this time, we're going to take a 10-minute break. So if you'd like, just feel free to chat and roam around, or if you want to check the book tables, you're also welcome to do so. So we'll take a 10-minute break, and we'll come back for the first round of rebuttals. Thank you. I have an important announcement to make about the question and answer period. For the question and answer period, we are going to be taking written questions. They're not going to be oral questions from the floor. They're going to be written questions, and the way it's going to work is, after the speakers have their concluding remarks, we are going to be collecting written questions. We want you to address either Sadat or Alex. And the way we're going to do the Q&A is, we only have enough time to do 5 questions each. Now the way it's going to work is, we're going to put all the questions in a box separately, one for Sadat and one for Alex. And I'm going to randomly choose 5 questions at a time. Well, 5 in total, but I'll be picking a question randomly, just to be fair. So if we don't get to your questions, we apologize, but considering the time restraints, we only have time for 5 questions each. A total of 10, but 5 questions each. And the person who you ask the question to will have 2 minutes to respond, the other party will have 1 minute to respond, and alternatively, we'll do it that way. So please bear in mind, if you have any questions, even now or during the rebuttal period, please jot them down. We're going to have someone come by with some paper, and I see Raphael is quickly running to get the paper, so he's going to start distributing some paper along. And if you have any questions, please indicate to whom it's for, Sadat or Alex, and then we'll collect them at the end, and we're going to take your questions. So at this time, I'm going to ask Sadat to come forward and to present his first rebuttal of 12 minutes. Sadat, please help me welcome you.
A number of issues were brought up. I won't be able to address all of them. I'll try to address as many as I can. First of all, there's a misunderstanding that there's Quranic verses that are talking about concealment, hiding, or misinterpreting, or verbally changing the Torah by the Jews. And Alex is using that to say that there was no textual corruption of the Jews. But the two are not mutually exclusive. Both of those things could be done. So I'm not negating or denying the meaning of those verses that Alex quoted from. Both of those things could have happened. There could have been a textual corruption, and there can be a corruption in the verbal interpretation of the book. Those two things are not mutually exclusive. The clearest verse, and the only verse actually that I brought up, was Quran chapter 2, verse 79. يَكْتُبُونَ الْكِتَابَ بِأَيْدِهِمْ ثُمَّ يَكُونُونَ هَذَا مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ. They write the scripture with their own hands. The preceding verses are talking about the Jews. They write the scripture with their own hands, and then they attribute it to God. That doesn't sound to me like just concealment or like a misinterpretation. That sounds like textual corruption that is going on. That can't be denied. Alex said, if you look at the preceding verse, which is verse 78, it says that amongst the Jews are some illiterate people who don't know the book. And he's implying that in 279, it's those illiterate people who are writing the book with their own hands and saying that it's from God. This obviously doesn't make sense, because illiterate people don't write books, right? So that is talking about one issue of people, Jews who don't know the book, who misinterpret the book. And then verse 279, it's talking about a different issue, which is about textual corruption of the book. Again, this is not some high-flying conspiracy theory. This is modern-day scholarship. Alex showed you a pamphlet of the Dead Sea Scrolls. I've got about 8-9 books here on the Dead Sea Scrolls. I didn't pick out the books that I wanted or that I needed. I just looked them up in the Toronto Library catalog and I caught whatever I could. All of them are confirming the same thing. They're not confirming what Alex is saying. They're confirming that there was a fluid textual tradition, there were different versions of the Torah, and that we don't know what that Ur text or that original Torah was. There are manuscripts in the Dead Sea Scrolls that are confirming the Septuagint Torah. There are manuscripts there that are confirming the Samaritan Torah, which researchers are starting to take more seriously now. And there are some manuscripts which definitely they label as proto-Masoretic. Now, I'm guessing Alex is with the Masoretic Torah, but he should tell us in the rebuttals. I would like to know, is he asking me to affirm the Masoretic Torah, or the Peshitta, or the Samaritan, or the Septuagint? Which one is he affirming? And which one did Prophet Muhammad affirm? Which one did his disciples affirm? If Prophet Muhammad was affirming the Torah wholesale, which Torah wholesale was it? Was it the Samaritan Torah, or was it the Septuagint, or the Masoretic? Did he believe Lamech lived till 653 days, or 777 days? Which one did he affirm? Right here in the Story of the Scrolls by Giza Vermis, who himself is a Jew, he talks about textual elasticity in the Dead Sea Scrolls. He says the Qumran scribes arrogated to themselves the right to creative freedom and considered it their duty to improve the work that they were propagating. So as they were propagating the Word of God, they were also improving the Word of God. Do you see the convergence between this and the Qur'an? يَكْتُبُونَ الْكِتَابَ بِأَيْدِهِمْ. They wrote the book with their own hands, and then they attributed it to God. Alex brought up one of the favorite verses that I've seen missionaries bring up, which is the Qur'an says in chapter 10, verse 94, to ask those people who were reading the scripture before you. So it's not saying, Alex, it's not saying go to that Reform Jewish synagogue or go to that Orthodox Jewish synagogue and ask them what version of the Torah they had. It's not saying that. It's saying ask those people who were reading the scripture before you. That means I can go to the Samaritans, I can go to the Greek Orthodox Christians, I can go to the Catholics. It doesn't say I have to go to the Pentecostals or to the Evangelical Christians. And each one of these groups has a different answer as to what constitutes the Torah. Also in Tafsir al-Jalalain by As-Suyuti, he says that this verse also includes those people who became Muslim. In other words, those Jews and Christians who were reading the Jewish and Christian scriptures and who became Muslim, like Abdullah ibn Salam, who was a Jewish rabbi who converted to Islam. Now again, Alex did what I expected him to do. He talked about how the Torah could not have been changed after the time of the Prophet Muhammad. He is omitting, I hope you see that, he's omitting the first 1,000 years of the history of the Torah. That's not a small period. None of the manuscripts that he mentioned, none of the Dead Sea Scroll manuscript fragments fall into that 1,000 year window from between, let's say, 1300 BCE, the time of Moses, and 300 BCE. And now, Abraham ibn Ezra, this is a Jewish scholar, he talks about Deuteronomy 2.12, he also talks about these anachronisms. He says that Deuteronomy 2.12, where it says the Horim, or the Horites, used to live in Seir, but the descendants of Esau drove them out. They destroyed the Horites from before them and settled in their place just as Israel did in the land that the Lord gave them. But at the time of Deuteronomy chapter 2, God had not given the land to the Jews yet. He had not given them the promised land. So how can it be talking about what the Jews did when they conquered the land? So even Jewish rabbis are part of that global Torah change conspiracy, I suppose, because they too are realizing that there's things that simply don't fit in properly in the text of the Torah. Alex brought up a couple of hadiths. One was from Sunan Abu Dawud, in which the Prophet Muhammad, that is, sits in front of the Torah and he says, "I believed in thee and him who revealed thee." These are open to interpretation because what exactly did he believe in? Did he believe that the physical hardcover, if there was one, it was probably a scroll, but if there was a physical hardcover, did that hardcover fall down from heaven? Did that come from heaven? Or was it the ink on the scrolls that came down from heaven? What is he affirming that is from God? In the context of that hadith, I believe it's clear that he is affirming that there are commandments in the Torah, even today, which I affirmed in my introduction, that even the present-day Torah contains the words of God. He's saying, "I believe in thee," meaning that commandment of the stoning of the adulterers, which is found in Deuteronomy, by the way. Moreover, the hadith, as he pointed out, is not considered sahih or authentic. It's considered as a hasan. And the reason for that is because there's a problematic person in the chain of narrators, and that's Hisham ibn Sa'd. Alex mentioned, I'm not sure because the discussion is not the Quran, but he mentioned the Hafs reading of the Quran and the Warsh reading of the Quran. And he said he's happy to accept Muslim tradition in as far as we believe that the Quran today can be traced back to the Prophet Muhammad. He should then also accept Muslim tradition, which has it that the Quran was revealed in different variants. So we believe that the Hafs reading of the Quran came from God. We believe that the Warsh reading of the Quran came from God. If you find that difficult to understand, then think about the Ten Commandments in Exodus 20, then the different version of the Ten Commandments in Deuteronomy 5, and then a different version of the Ten Commandments in Exodus 34. Why are there three different versions? Modern-day scholars say that this is because different writers wrote the Ten Commandments in different ways, and they did write them differently. They didn't make 15 commandments, but they did change them, and they even changed the order of the commandments. I didn't bring up those three variations in the Ten Commandments because I wanted to be consistent. I didn't want to say that three variants of the Ten Commandments can be revealed by God because I know that the Quran has the Hafs and the Warsh recensions, both of which are revealed by God. I rather brought up the examples which cannot be reconciled, which are from different versions of the Torah. Septuagint, Samaritan, Peshitta, they're saying different things. Alex said quite correctly that these variants in the Hafs and the Warsh do not have any meaningful differences or they don't result in any significant differences. But can he say the same about the differences in the different versions of the Torah? When Deuteronomy, according to the Masoretic text, says that God commanded the Israelites to build an altar of worship on Mount Ebal, but then the Samaritan version is saying that God commanded, in the same passage in Deuteronomy, God commanded the Israelites to build an altar of worship on Mount Gerizim. So which one is it? In this case, no Christian or no Jew believes that God revealed both of these commandments because they're in contradiction to one another. And if the Dead Sea Scrolls are so important to Alex, then he should go with the Samaritan reading, because the oldest fragment that we have of that passage of Deuteronomy has Mount Gerizim. It's affirmed the Samaritan reading. So if Dead Sea Scrolls are important to Alex, he should give up his Masoretic Torah and he should adopt the Samaritan Torah. I think a bigger question than whether the Quran affirms the Torah wholesale, that is, it does affirm the Torah, we're not denying that, but does it affirm it wholesale? A bigger question and a more pertinent question for Christians should be, does Jesus actually affirm the Torah wholesale? Does the Old Testament actually affirm the Torah wholesale? For example, in Genesis 50:13, it says that Jacob was buried in Hebron. But in Acts 7:16, so we're talking not Old Testament, but New Testament, it says Jacob was buried in Shechem. So is Paul affirming or is he denying Genesis 50:13? How about Deuteronomy 12:31, where it says God abhors a human sacrifice? God abhors or hates human sacrifice. But then in Judges chapter 11, verses 29-39, God accepts, or he presumably accepts, the sacrifice of Jephthah's daughter. You might remember that incident where he takes a vow and he says that he's going to burn his, well, not that he'll burn his daughter alive, but whoever walks in through the door and she happens to be that unfortunate person. So nowhere in the text, nowhere in the New Testament, nowhere in the Old Testament is Jephthah taken to account for that. Is he criticized for that? Is he corrected for that? So is even the Old Testament, is even that affirming the Torah or not? Now, it's true that Jesus, he gave an example in the New Testament of Jesus affirming the Torah, making reference to the law and the prophets. That raises another question of why didn't he refer to the law and the writings and the prophet, which make up that Tanakh that you have over there. So there's something fishy going on over there as well. But the fact that Jesus affirmed parts of Torah is not a problem, because I, as a Muslim, affirm parts of the Torah, and I accept that Prophet Muhammad affirmed parts of the Torah. The question is, did Jesus and Muhammad affirm the Torah wholesale? Or did they know something that today's Christians don't know? In Matthew 5:38, Jesus says, "You have heard it said, eye for an eye and tooth for a tooth. But I tell you, do not resist an evil person. If anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to them the other cheek." That sort of, to me, sounds like a criticism of the old Torah law, which according to Christians, Jesus himself had revealed in Deuteronomy 19:21, where it says, eye for an eye, and then it says, your eyes shall not pity him. So how do you reconcile eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth, and your eyes should not pity him, versus you heard it said eye for an eye, but you should pity him, turn the other cheek? So this too has been interpreted by scholars as Jesus critiquing the Torah, but in a subtle way, because Jesus is not picking a fight with the Torah text of his day. Prophet Muhammad and the Quran are not picking a fight with the text of the Torah day. But when push comes to shove, we affirm the Torah in the same way that most liberal Christians today are affirming it. If you step out of this church and you ask any Roman Catholic Christian on the street, you ask most Greek Orthodox Christians on the street, you ask liberal Anglicans on the street. In our own country here in Canada, the United Church of Canada, if you were to ask members of the United Church, all of them will affirm and say they believe in the Bible. But when push comes to shove, they're not ready to affirm each and every point in the Bible, including in the Torah, because they realize that there are some mistakes which are there.
Time?
Thank you.
To come and give this 12-minute rebuttal. Thank you.
Please do not disturb me. I'm trying to get something.
Okay, I have a problem. Actually, as a matter of fact, I have a problem since I started preparing myself for the debate. I'm running all the time. And as you saw, I didn't finish my first presentation, and I still have several slides more on. And you know what? I'd like to ask Mr. Sadat and my Muslim friends, if you allow me for a few more minutes to finish my presentation, then start 12 minutes of rebuttal. If you say yes, I'll go. If you say no, that's fine. So if you...
I think that'll be between you and Sadat.
Well, if I can get that extra time as well, then...
I'm sorry?
If I could get that extra time as well,
so
it would be fair.
Whatever time you use up, Alex, I'll have to credit Sadat. But
even
also
more,
bear in mind the people as well. We don't want to keep the people here too long either. So please do bear that in mind.
Are you okay, guys?
Okay.
You okay? Thank you very much. That's second.
Okay.
Okay, I show you like Christian Bibles existing in the 7th century AD, and I show you that to change all of those Bibles, maybe not some of them, say how many hundreds of years do we need to really to change those Bibles to make it, to remove supposedly Muhammad, peace be upon him, the time, information about him from all the Genesis 1-1, and I explain you that we have, it must be major, massive, global Torah change conspiracy among Jews and Christians, not among Muslims. And yes, that will be even bigger than even the recent one, the recycling Jewish conspiracy. Okay? Well, now the second question I pose and I want to ask them, when do you think this conspiracy finally stopped? When the Christian Jews said, well, it's enough, we have 1001 versions, and we stop it. And let's adopt one version, more or less, to everybody. And of course, at least in the name of Muhammad, which is supposed to be before the Muhammad, peace be upon him, and after him, it means the time when they stop finally doing any changes, it's only after Muhammad, peace be upon him. Then we go to the textual aspect of that. Okay? We have Christian Bibles, the Coptic Bible, Latin, Cyrillic, Armenian, Byzantine texts, and others. We have manuscripts as old as for the 1st to the 5th century, which means about 100 to 200 years before Muhammad, peace be upon him, was alive on this earth. And also we have Jewish Septuagint, Jewish scripture, which is Septuagint, 2nd century BC, before Christ. This is called 2nd century BC. And yet we have this information of the Genesis of Dead Sea Scrolls and the Genesis of today Bible, or the Torah, are extremely similar, and yet we don't have what Muhammad, peace be upon him, said that to the Jews of Hebron, saying, you will find that in your scripture, and we read the quotation. And also, let's go back to the story of creation, of course, and all this, Genesis from Dead Sea Scrolls up to date, Genesis 1-1 and 1-2, they are like we see it now, identical. Almost virtually the same. Therefore, when I read this from Islamic sources and from website today, Muslim website today, when they're speaking about authentic narration, the first line of the Torah and second line of the Torah speaking about Muhammad, peace be upon him, rather than creation of the universe, now it's my time to say, well, I don't believe that. Okay. Now my time starts.
Okay, so Sadat will have, I got here 2 minutes and 54 seconds, so.
3 minutes.
Well, I'll give you three, we'll round it off. In Canada, we don't count the pennies, so we'll round it off to three, so you'll have in your next rebuttal period, you'll have 8 minutes.
Thank you very much. Okay, now, can we talk to the story? Now, I show you three verses from the Quran, then the Quran supposedly confirmed the Torah in Jewish possession of 7th century AD. But there are more to that. There are about 14 of them. And you can see them on the screen. And let me remind you one. O children of Israel, believe in that I have sent down this Quran, confirming that which is with you. Now, we could look at it as, let's say, the Quran as a book or revelation, confirm the Torah as a revelation. In whole. Or the guy also that could say, well, I disagree with that. So the some parts of the Quran confirms some parts of the Torah. And he has a point, because the text of the Quran, it's very broad. It's not telling specifically what's confirmed. But so we have to find the verse which is very specific. And yes, we do have one. And it's in Surah 12:11. And it's found in the story of Joseph. It's only complete biblical story in the Quran you can find. So let's read verse 3 from the story. We reveal unto you, Muhammad, peace be upon him, the best of stories through our revelations unto you of this Quran. Let's read the last words. Indeed, in their stories, Joseph, Jacob, brothers, and other prophets, even people who were present at that time, there is a lesson for men of understanding. The Quran is not a forged statement, but a confirmation of Allah's existing books which were before it, the Torah, Injil, and other scriptures of Allah, and a detailed explanation of everything and guide and mercy for people who believe. Well, we don't have time to go from all the prophets, as it's claimed here, to be correct. So we can look only on the story of Joseph, and we can look only, we have time only to look at a small fragment of the story of Joseph. So let's see, this fragment of the story of Joseph is the best of stories, is not a forged statement, is a confirmation of the Torah, is a detailed explanation of everything, and a guide and a mercy of people who believe. So we'll focus on this one, and the confirmation of the Torah. So Joseph was sold by his brothers to Egypt, and now let's read what happened after. Let's read the Quran. And they, brothers, came to their father Jacob at nightfall weeping. They said, "Oh father, we were racing with one another and left Yusuf by our belongings, and the wolf devoured him, but you will not believe us, thought you will never believe us, even though they speak the truth." And they brought his shirt stained with the false blood. He said, "Nay, but your own selves have made up a tale. So for me, patience is most fitting, and is Allah alone whose help could be sought against that lie which you describe." Let's go to the Torah. And they took a Joseph coat and killed a kid of goats and dipped the coat in the blood. And they sent the coat of many colors, and they brought it to their father and said, "These have we found. Know now whether it be thy son's coat or not." And he knew it and said, "It is my son's coat, an evil beast has devoured him." Joseph is without doubt rent in pieces. And Jacob rent his cloth and put sackcloth upon his loins and mourned for his son many days. Let's bring these two stories together. According to the Quran, brothers told their father that Joseph was dead, and his father accused the brothers of lying. The brothers were crying about Joseph, they missed not their father. According to the Torah, it's all the way around. It's all opposite. The brothers didn't tell their father that Joseph was killed. Jacob concluded on his own accord that Joseph was dead. Joseph's father had cried over his death. The brothers did not cry and were unsuccessfully trying to comfort him. And that story didn't end here. Let's go to the Quran, when Joseph revealed himself in Egypt, and he said, "Go with this sword of mine and cast it over the face of my father, he will become clear-sighted, and bring me all your family." And then the caravan departed, their father said, "I do indeed feel the smell of Yusuf, if only you think me not a daughter." They say, "By Allah, certainly you are in your old error." Then when the bearer of glad tidings arrived, he cast it over the face of his father and became clear-sighted. He said, "Did I not say to you, I know from Allah, which you don't know?" Let's go to the Torah. And they went out of Egypt and came into the land of Canaan, unto Jacob their father, and told him, saying, "Joseph is yet alive, and he is the governor over all the land of Egypt." And what? And Jacob's heart fainted, for what? He believed them not. And they told him all the words of Joseph, which he has said unto them, and they basically saw the baggage which Joseph has sent to carry him. The spirit of Jacob, their father, revived, and Israel said, actually, he probably cried out, "It's enough! Joseph, my son, is yet alive. I'll go to see him before I die." Well, we have a big problem here. Well, I have to tell you first, all King James Bible, New King James Bible, NIV, ESV, even the Message Bible, are the agreeing with this story. Every story. Well, the Coptic Bible, Latin Vulgate, Syriac Peshitta, Armenian Bible, Byzantine, agree. And you know why? Because the source agreeing. They came from Hebrew source, not Variation of the text is fine, but the story narration never changed. So now we have a problem here. Is the story of the Joseph in the Quran is the best of stories? Is it not a forged statement? Is it confirmation of the Torah? Detailed explanation of everything and the guide? Well, as you see now, I show you one reason why Muslims today will deny or reject the Torah, especially in the Dead Sea Scrolls variant, because it simply threatens the integrity of the Quran. But not only that, it will threaten the integrity of the Hadith of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Okay? And the most rock-solid doctrine of Islam. The question, was Muhammad an Arab Quraysh tribe descendant of Ishmael? Well, let's read the source. Hadith, Sahih Bukhari, it said, Sheikh Hagar lived in that way in Mecca area until some people from a tribe of Jurum, a family of Jurum, passed by her the child. The child Ishmael grew up and learned Arabic from them, and his virtue caused them to love and admire him as he grew up. And when he reached the age of puberty, they made him marry a woman from Amman's Denmark. Okay, that's very interesting. Let's go to the Torah. And we see, and God was with the lad, and he grew and dwelt in the wilderness and became an archer, and he dwelt in the wilderness of Paran. His mother took him a wife out of the land of Egypt. So my Muslim friends sometimes say, well, it's a mistake, it's not Faran, it should be Paran, or maybe. We'll address that issue later. But first of all, look at this passage. His mother took him a wife out of the land of Egypt. Let's bring these two passages together in comparison. And according to the Hadith, the 12th son of Ishmael is supposed to be 25% Chaldean by blood through the Abraham, 25% by blood through the Hagar, Egyptian by blood through the Hagar, and 50% Arabs by blood through the wife of Ishmael. According to the Torah, they are 25% by blood Chaldean, 75% Egyptian through the Hagar and the wife, and nothing Arabs. So immediate descendant of Ishmael had nothing to do with Arab. But if the Ishmael lived in Mecca, in the Paran, I should say, well, does it matter?
Sure.
Maybe. Let's read. Let's go back to the story of Joseph again. But let's read one verse when Joseph was thrown on the pit. And they sat down and to eat the bread. And they lifted up their eyes and looked, and behold, the company of Ishmaelites came from Gilead with their camels bearing spices and balm and myrrh, going to carry it down to Egypt. Well, let's see the map. Father sent Joseph to go from Hebron to Shechem to check the welfare of the brothers, not to guard their belongings as they are running, playing games as a small children. They were doing serious business there. But he didn't find them there. He went up to north to the Dothan, and he was thrown in the pit. Now what happened is, you see the map, right side, the Gilead, the Ishmaelites were coming from Gilead, purchased Joseph by accident, and went down to Egypt. If the story of the Hadith is true, then Ishmaelites are supposed to be living in Mecca. And let's say if they travel to Egypt, they have to go up here to Gulf of Aqaba, and I ask you, where should they turn, left or right? To Egypt? Well, yes, of course it's left, right? But in order for them to come from Mecca and purchase Joseph by accident, without receiving any emails or SMS from brothers of Joseph, they have to turn right, purchase Joseph, and say, well, wait, Lebanon, no, Egypt, and turn it and go down. Well, it doesn't make sense, this detour. Okay, then what I have to conclude is Joseph was thrown in a pit in that part of Canaan, and then Ishmaelites must be living in Jordan area, not in Mecca, Saudi Arabia. Therefore, I have to say again that today's Torah, the main problem I believe, that's my personal belief, that Muslims will deny the Torah as well as God, will reject it and find anything to reject it. The main one is because the Torah not only threatened the integrity of the Quran, it's also threatened the integrity of whatever Muhammad, peace be upon him, said, and threatened the integrity of most solid statement of doctrines of Islam. Thank you, and done.
Amen.
you very much, Alex. And as I pointed out earlier, Sadat will have an extra 3 minutes. So for your rebuttal, second rebuttal, you do have 8 minutes. Sadat.
The statement that I found most amusing was that the Dead Sea Scrolls undermines the authenticity of the Quran. That was for me the most interesting thing, because it wasn't the Quran, it wasn't variant manuscripts of the Quran that they dug up in those caves in Qumran. It was manuscripts of the Torah. Dr. Sidney White Crawford, who's a scholar of the Dead Sea Scrolls, says in an article called The Fluid Bible, that tells you all you need to know, The Fluid Bible, the blurry line between biblical and non-biblical texts. She says, the Dead Sea Scrolls reveal a surprising fact. Even in the case of the Torah, there was no fixed text, either of the Torah as a whole or of any of the individual books. Amongst the scroll is a whole group of texts that are related to but different from the present-day books of the canonical Torah. Some of the texts are simply copies of biblical books with variants, the results of centuries of hand copying. Then she puts in brackets, scribal error or manipulation, and textual growth. Some of these texts differ markedly, at times startlingly, from the standard authoritative Jewish version of the Bible, known as the Masoretic text. Nor do they resemble the two other major biblical textual traditions, the Septuagint and the Samaritan Pentateuch. So you tell me what the Dead Sea Scrolls are saying. Are they saying it's bringing the authenticity of the Quran into the question, or is it bringing the authenticity of the Torah into question? I'm still waiting on an answer on which version of the Torah God, Alex wants me to affirm. Like, is it the Masoretic text that you follow? Okay. Okay, since Alex wants me to affirm the Masoretic text. According to him, Prophet Muhammad affirmed the Masoretic text, even though the Masoretic text didn't come into existence until 2 to 4 centuries after the time of the Prophet Muhammad. It's only then that the vowel markings and the accents and everything were put in. But if he wants me to affirm the Masoretic Torah, then prove to me first that the New Testament affirms the Masoretic Torah. In Hebrews chapter 1, verse 6, it quotes from the Torah, it says, "And let all the angels of God worship him." This you find in Deuteronomy 32, verse 43, but only in the Septuagint version. You don't find it in Alex's version. You won't find it in that Masoretic version, which is translated by Jews. So what happened to that verse? Is it not lost? You would have to then accept that a verse from Deuteronomy, part of the Torah, has been lost. Paul was quoting it in Hebrews chapter 1, verse 6, but we don't have it anymore. So now he is engaging in a Torah change conspiracy after the time of Jesus and after the time of Paul. Similarly, in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 6, quotes from Psalm chapter 40, verse 6, "Sacrifice and offering you did not desire, but a body you have prepared for me." That's how Paul quotes it. But when you go back to Psalm 46, I challenge Alex to come up and show me from his Torah, show me where it says that a body you have prepared for me. Yes, you'll find that in the Septuagint Torah, but you won't find that in the Masoretic Torah. What about Matthew 12:21, where he's quoting from Isaiah chapter 42, verses 1 to 4? Matthew ends by quoting, "And in his name shall the Gentiles trust." But this is not found in Isaiah 42 in the Masoretic version. So only until Alex can show us that, he should show us these verses from the Masoretic Torah, then we too can affirm the Masoretic Torah. Otherwise, it seems that Jesus' disciples or apostles might have been quoting from the Septuagint. Also, if the Masoretic is correct, then why does your King James Version quote from the Septuagint in Psalm 22:16 when it says, "They pierced my hands and my feet"? Here, the King James Version translators conveniently jump over to the Septuagint in order to prove a theological point. It doesn't say that in the Masoretic text. Alex says that it's unthinkable, and he made fun of that. It's unthinkable that Jews could come together and they could all agree to change the Torah after the time of the Prophet Muhammad. They don't have to agree. Who said they agreed? That's why you have different versions of the Torah, because obviously they did not agree. Greek Orthodox Christians couldn't be convinced by the Masoretes who wrote the Masoretic text. They weren't convinced by that. Till this day, they don't accept that. The other thing is that every modern translation of the Bible is essentially an eclectic translation. If you read any modern critical version of the Bible, it's an eclectic tradition, which means it combines from the different versions. Sometimes they will go with a manuscript of the Masoretic Torah. Sometimes they will go with a manuscript of the Septuagint Torah. They'll say, this is the superior reading here. Or they'll take it from the Samaritan. They'll say, we have these reasons to believe that this is the superior reading here. Guess what they're doing? They're creating a new Torah. They're creating a new Torah when they do that, because by making an eclectic version of the Bible, by borrowing from the different manuscripts, what they're essentially doing is they're creating a Torah which never existed before. So that process is happening right now as we speak. Moreover, I also showed that the verbal corruption or verbal twisting of the Torah, that is not inconsistent with the idea of textual changing and textual corruption of the Torah. So let me give you an example. The example I've given earlier on, Ishmael, will he be a wild man or will he be a fruitful man? Now you might say that doesn't make much of a theological difference, it's not theologically significant, but clearly it is. Because Christian missionaries like to tell us that Prophet Muhammad is from the line of Ishmael, and Ishmael is a wild donkey or something like that. How they got that, I'm not sure, because all the Hebrew word says is pere, which means wild. The Samaritan version says para, which is fruitful. Now you can imagine a prophet coming from the descendants of a man, Ishmael, who God says is going to be a fruitful man, not a wild man, a fruitful man. So which version is it? Which one did Prophet Muhammad read? When he was reading Deuteronomy, did he read in Arabic, did he read that Ishmael is going to be a wild man, or did he read that Ishmael is going to be a fruitful man? Which version did he read? And again, the main point that I want to emphasize is that repeatedly, Alex only covered the time after Jesus or after the time of the Prophet Muhammad. He did not cover the first 1,000 years, which are dark years. We know nothing. I mean, just prove to me that the Torah existed 900 BCE. Prove to me that the Torah even existed as it does in its present day form in 800 BCE or in 700 BCE or in 600 BCE. We can't do that because those years are dark years. We know nothing. How do you account for the fact that during the time of King Josiah, as I said, they were not even aware of the basic commandment that you shouldn't worship idols? You shouldn't build altars and kill your kids, sacrifice your children on them. How did that happen? That's Judaism for dummies. That's Judaism 101. Everyone knows that in Judaism, you don't worship statues and idols and you don't put them in the temple. Why were they so unaware of this during the time of Josiah? If the Torah had never been lost, the Torah had never been forgotten, the Torah had never been corrupted, the Torah had never been changed. Similarly, during the time of Ezra, as I pointed out, I'm waiting for him to address that in the rebuttals. They didn't know that you're supposed to live in booths during the time of the Feast of Tabernacles. But that's in the book of Leviticus. Didn't they ever read the book of Leviticus? So we have proven transmission breaks even before the time of the Prophet Muhammad and even before the time of Jesus. This is probably what led Jeremiah to say in the book of Jeremiah, chapter 8, verse 8. Jeremiah says, "How can we say that we are wise, and that the Torah of God is with us? For the scribes have falsified it with their pens." I'm paraphrasing, but that's in Jeremiah 8:8. He's not talking about here verbal corruption, because he's saying they falsified it with their pens.
Okay, this is now the second. Yes, please go ahead. This will be the second rebuttal, and it's 5 minutes now.
Am I connected?
Oh, yeah.
Thank you. All right, so let's go for 5 minutes. I want to give you one evidence that proved that Jews never changed the Torah. Well, again, I have to use the same article of Bassam Zawadi, and I will show you a few statements of companions of Muhammad, peace be upon him. Therefore, what severe punishment, and it is said this means a valley in hell be unto those who write the scripture with their hands. Change the description and traits of Muhammad, peace be upon him, in the Torah. Ibn Abbas, commentary on Surah 279. Tafsir ibn Kathir said, because they, the Jews, distorted the Torah, they added to it what they liked, and they erased from it what they hated, and they erased the name of Muhammad, peace be upon him, from the scripture, from the Torah, and for that Allah became angry. Again, the view of Ibn Uthman Affan. Again, commentary on Surah 279. Early Quranic commentator said, the leaders of the Jews in Medina erased the description of traits of Muhammad, peace be upon him, from the Torah, and they wrote other traits of description. Okay, let's go to now, Old Testament. And I have to bring, again, this scroll is my favorite subject. And now it goes to Isaiah, great Isaiah scroll. I want to read from chapter 53. Surely our disease did he bear, and our pains he carried, thereas we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, and yet did he not open his mouth. Like a lamb he was led to the slaughter, as a sheep that before its shearers he is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away, and this is judgment generation. Who did reason? For he was cut off from the land of the living, for the transgression of my people, to whom the stroke was due. Of the travail of his soul he shall see to the full. Even my servant, who is by his knowledge, did justify the righteous one to the many, and their iniquities did he bear. Therefore will I give him, divide him in a portion among the great, and he shall divide their spoils with the mighty, because he bared his soul unto the dead, and he was numbered for the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors. And I assure you, my Muslim friends, and you know it very well, because the Christians are using these passages of Isaiah 53 for almost 2,000 years to prove Christ's crucifixion and resurrection. And start with Philip and Enoch. Okay, and we can read from Acts, and it's recorded in the New Testament. And the angel of the Lord spake unto Philip, saying, arise, and go towards the south, to the way of goes down to Jerusalem, to Gaza, which is desert. And he arose and went, and behold, a man of Ethiopia has come to Jerusalem for to worship. He was returning and sitting in his chariot to read Isaiah the prophet. The place of the scripture when he was read was this: he was led as a sheep to the slaughter, and like a lamb down before his shearer, so opened he not his mouth. In his humiliation, his judgment was taken away, and who shall declare his generation? For his life was taken from the earth. And the Enoch answered Philip and said, I pray thee, of whom speaketh the prophet this, of himself or of some other man? Then Philip opened his mouth and began at the same scripture and preached unto him Jesus. And as they went on their way, they came unto the certain water, and the Enoch said, see, there is a water. What doth hinder me to be baptized? And Philip said, if thou believest with all thy heart, thou mayest. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Well, I have to say, if Jews were so wicked, they changed God's word in connection with Muhammad, peace be upon him, why did the strongest passage about the crucifixion of Jesus, which speaks against the Quran, as a matter of fact, and the Jews, they don't like it as well, survive from the Dead Sea Scrolls until today? If we follow Muslim logic, the passage should have been removed first, before any passage about Muhammad, but it wasn't. Therefore, I have to say that allegations toward the Jews of changing the Torah are illogical, make no sense, and contradict the fact. So my conclusion is, archaeological discoveries of the last century confirmed the Torah was had never been changed during the last 2,139 years.
You have 2 seconds to go, but that's okay. Okay, now we enter the phase of the debate tonight where we deal with the conclusions, and each speaker will have 12 minutes. Again, a reminder for questions and answers. Please indicate who you want to ask the question to Sadat or to Alex. And then during the Q&A, I'm going to randomly select five questions for each of the speakers. And the question to whom the speaker is given, you'll have 2 minutes, and the other party will have 1 minute to respond. So we're entering the conclusion. I'm going to ask Sadat again to come up and present us with his 12-minute concluding statements.
Thank you.
Thank you. I began with Yakubuna Kitava bi Aidihim Thumma Yakununa Haramin in the La. They, the Jews, wrote the scripture of the book with their own hands and then they attributed it to God. This would have sounded like a conspiracy theory to most Jews and Christians back in the 7th century of the Common Era. Today, however, we see this Quranic verse with its historical insight vindicated by the Dead Sea Scrolls and other manuscript discoveries. Today, in various ways, biblical scholars of the Pentateuch are affirming that people wrote it with their own hands. And then they attributed it to Moses and thus to God. Keep in mind that we've only briefly examined only 5 books of the Bible. There's a total of 66 books. Or 73 if you follow the Catholic canon of the Bible. So the point being that we've already run into the red, we've already run into trouble with just 5 out of the 66 books. I began by making brief mention of the documentary hypothesis, the most dominant hypothesis in academia today regarding the composition of the Torah. And we saw that this hypothesis holds that there were at least 4 different strands of the Torah. Just like we have the Gospels, Gospel according to Mark and Gospel according to Luke, etc. Similarly, we have 4 different versions or subversions of the Torah within any given one version of the Torah. We have the Torah according to the J source, the Torah according to the E source, the Torah according to the D source, and the Torah according to the P source. And they often have different views. Alex, in his rebuttals, I was hoping that he was going to address some of those points, like Genesis 1. Was animals created first, or Genesis 2, were the human beings created first? That's 2 different versions of the creation account in Genesis. Without having gone into the details of this specific hypothesis, that is the documentary hypothesis, I still presented other general and specific points that would indicate that today's Pentateuch or Torah is not the same Holy Torah as the one that was revealed to the prophet Moses, and that the Torah must have been changed and corrupted long before the time of Muhammad and even before the time of Jesus, and Alex didn't address that. In fact, I said in my introduction that he would probably spend most of his time on trying to prove that the Torah had not been changed after Muhammad, but I was wrong. He spent his entire presentation trying to show that the Torah was not changed after the time of the Prophet Muhammad. And by tackling that straw man, he denied the scope and the variety of Muslim views and opinions on where, when, and how the Torah was changed. Some of the names of notable Muslim scholars who said that the Torah had been changed before the time of Muhammad include Ibn Hazm and Ibn Taymiyyah. Both of them spoke about this problem of broken transmission by the time of Ezra. Ibn Kathir in Al-Bidayah wa Nihayah comments on the translation of the Torah that he had read, and he said that no sane person can believe it. More importantly than this, Ibn Abbas, because Alex quoted from Sahih Bukhari. In Sahih Bukhari, you have Ibn Abbas, the disciple and the companion of the Prophet Muhammad, and he also understood the Quran chapter 2 verse 79 to mean that the Jews had undertaken textual tampering of their scriptures. I earlier on already vindicated Ibn Kathir, where he was quoting from Uthman ibn Affan, saying that the Jews took away what they didn't like and they added what they liked. How can you deny that? You have to affirm that the Samaritans added Mount Gerizim because they liked it. They took out Mount Ebal because they didn't like it. Or if you take their side of the debate, then it is the mainstream Jews who added Mount Ebal because they liked it. And they took away Mount Gerizim because they didn't like it. Even though earlier on in Deuteronomy, Mount Ebal is the mountain of the cursing, and Mount Gerizim is the mountain of the blessing. So we saw there's a remarkable convergence between what this verse of the Quran 279 that is says, and what modern day scholarship of the Torah is saying. Richard Friedman, Dr. Richard Friedman, and who wrote the Bible, page 28, he's a Harvard PhD and professor of Hebrew, he says there is hardly a biblical scholar in the world actively working on the problem who would claim that the 5 books of Moses were written by Moses or by any one man. Rabbi Yaakov Menken in the Everything Torah book, also if you go to Torah.org, he's the director of that website, he admits the general concept of multiple authors quickly became the dominant view among Bible critics. Today one can find schools of thought claiming that the Torah as we know it came into existence in Solomon's time or in Ezra's time. They all reject the idea that the Torah came into existence at the hand of Moshe, or Moses, peace be upon him. So Alex is not just up against me or the straw man that he constructed, rather he's up against an ocean of biblical scholars on this issue. He's also contending with Jeremiah, as we saw. Jeremiah said, how can you say we are wise and the Torah of the Lord is with us? But behold, the false pen of the scribes has made it into a lie. In the definition of Torah that Alex gave, he didn't provide the definition which the Jews have, which is that it can include books even beyond the 5 books of Moses. For them, any of the books in the Old Testament are included in that. So if I were to affirm the entire Torah as the Jews see it, then I'm affirming Jeremiah 8:8, and Jeremiah 8:8 is undermining parts of Leviticus and Deuteronomy. Alex did try to show that certain Quranic verses and hadiths indicate that the Pentateuch is not corrupted. We saw upon closer examination those verses and hadiths are not saying what Alex thinks that they're saying. There's no way that verse 279 is talking about illiterate Jews, and then verse 279 is talking about those same illiterate Jews writing the book with their own hands and saying it's from God. Logically, that doesn't make sense. Out of the many points that I raised, Alex did not, he didn't respond satisfactorily, but actually he just ignored it completely. The problem of the canonization, the different versions, the problem of the broken transmission of the Torah, the problem of anachronisms, the problems of contradictions, none of these were even addressed. And certainly not the moral corruption of the prophets, which is an issue for me as a Muslim. And I'm addressing sort of the Muslims in the audience really now, is that if we believe that the present day Torah is uncorrupted, then we're forced to believe that the prophets of God are corrupted. Lot committing incest with his daughters, you all know in your hearts, you wouldn't let that person be the pastor of your church. You wouldn't let that person be the pastor of your church. So if we wish to vindicate God and the prophets of these allegations of corruption and immorality, then we are forced to believe that it is the present day Torah which is at fault. The present day Torah has some corruption or flaws in it. We have to choose our side. On the one side are God and his prophets, and on the other side are the anonymous scribes and priests and redactors who wrote and copied the Torah. As a Muslim, I say that the present day Pentateuch can be corrupt, but Abraham, Noah, Lot cannot be corrupt. The present day Torah can be corrupt, but Moses, peace be upon him, cannot be corrupt. The present day Torah can be corrupt, but Jesus cannot be corrupt. The scribes and the priests can be corrupt. They can be forgetful, they can be negligent in their duties of properly preserving and transmitting the Torah, but God Almighty cannot be negligent or forgetful of his commitments. He doesn't have to put a rainbow in the sky to remind himself of his commitment to not send another flood again. It doesn't make sense. And then he sends more floods anyhow. The biggest issue, however, that I've reiterated time and time again is that Alex banked his entire presentation on the idea that the Torah could not have been changed after the time of the Prophet Muhammad, even though it was, because the proponents of the Septuagint text will tell you that that's exactly what happened. Jews got together and they inserted vowel marks that God didn't give them. They inserted accents that God didn't give them. And as we saw in the case of Pere and Para, that can make a big theological difference as well. In essence, when Alex is saying that the Torah could not have been changed, what he really means is that his version of the Torah was not changed. That's really what he means. But by necessity, he has to acknowledge that the Septuagint has been changed then, hasn't it? That 70 Jewish scholars that came together around 250 BC or before that, and that's what they did. They cooked up a false Torah. But for some reason, we see that Paul is quoting in Acts, he's quoting from that cooked up Septuagint Torah, which Alex considers to be incorrect. It doesn't make sense. The reason this 1,000-year window is a big problem is, I give the example, if I had a teenage son or daughter, God forbid, who ran away from home for 10 years, and then they come back after 10 years, for me to just assume that they're still that same innocent child that they were 10 years ago, unchanged, uncorrupted by the world or by the society around them, that is wishful thinking. It's even more wishful thinking if I know that son or that daughter was rebellious, disobedient, and morally corrupt in the first place. And then they come back after 10 years with even more signs of moral corruption. So what is the example that the children of Israel had set for themselves in the first place, very early in the game? Moses had barely been away a few days on the mountain, and they had started worshipping the golden cow. That's a big bonus point for the Hindus, right? The Hindus win the debate. So within a few days, we see that the Israelites had changed and corrupted the very concept of God itself. The very concept of God, they lost that. They corrupted that. They lost and corrupted Tawheed. They lost and corrupted monotheism. If the Israelites could corrupt the very concept of God and throw God behind their backs, so to speak, how safe do you think the Torah was going to be in their hands? What's holier, God or the Torah? In fact, Moses predicted that they would act even more corruptly than this after his death. In Deuteronomy chapter 31, verse 27, Moses says to them, "For I know your rebellion and your stubbornness. Behold, while I am still alive with you today, you have been rebellious against the Lord. How much more then after my death? For I know that after my death you will act corruptly and turn away from the way which I have commanded you. And evil will befall you in the latter days, for you will do that which is evil in the sight of the Lord, provoking him to anger with the work of your hands." يَكْتُبُونَ الْكِتَابَ بِأَيْدِهِمْ. They wrote the scripture with their own hands. Moreover, even if the Torah, or whichever version, Masoretic version of the Torah, is 100% trustworthy, what does that actually mean? What does it actually prove? Does it vindicate Christianity? Are you going to stop eating pork? Are you going to stop worshiping the Trinity? Are you going to stop making fun of Muslims who marry more than one wife? Like, what will it actually change on a practical level? The ironic thing is that for a Trinitarian Christian actually has less reason to trust the Torah, because the Torah is not affirming Trinitarianism, it's affirming monotheism, unqualified monotheism, belief in one God. So for theological reasons alone, as a Muslim, I have more reason to trust the Torah than a Christian. And I reiterate again that I do. I do trust it with caveats and qualifications. Today's Torah is trustworthy in some limited way. In fact, I trust it in the same way that Roman Catholics and liberal Protestants and liberal and Reformed Jews trust it. Like them, I put some trust in the Torah, but cautiously and with a pinch of salt. The difference between them and us Muslims is probably only in how much is corrupted and what exactly is corrupted. For me, the present-day Torah or Pentateuch is like this bridge. Some say that it's very damaged, some would say it's not that damaged. Some would say the first part of the bridge is weaker, or the latter part of the bridge is weaker. But the inevitable conclusion must be that it is not a bridge you want to get stuck on. That is not a bridge you want to get stuck on. That's not a bridge you want to jump up and down on while yelling hallelujah. That would be an unwise and an irresponsible thing to do. This is a bridge that you need to navigate very carefully and with great caution, and cross it as quickly as you can in order to reach stronger and more stable ground. As a Muslim, I identify and consider Islam and the Quran and the authenticated teachings of Prophet Muhammad as that stronger and more stable ground, which is God-affirmed, not man-affirmed, and that is the destination that we need to progress to. I hope you will at least look across that bridge and examine or re-examine Islam and the Quran with an open heart. Thank you.
Five seconds, yeah, to go, but that's great. So Alex, you have 12 minutes for your concluding remarks. Thank you. Okay, thank you.
Well, as I'm connected, so I want to say, it seems for me like modern-day Muslims have more information about the corruption of the Torah than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had, and Muhammad, peace be upon him, think of. So, can we trust today's Torah? And I want to bring something from this book, and surprisingly I saw this book on a Muslim table, so I ask every Christian to grab the copy of this book and examine it thoroughly. So on this page 44 in this book, in the concept of sin, it said, Islam regards the concept of original sin and the need of atonement by God Himself via dying on the cross as a pure invention of those who came after Jesus Christ, declaring themselves as Christians. And of course, I heard many Muslims attacking specifically Apostle Paul of creating Christianity. Well, let's go to the Old Testament, the Tanakh. And let us read from Job 15:14. What is man who he should be, that he should be clean? And he should be born, or he which is born of woman, that should be righteous. Isaiah 64:6, but with all as unclean things, and all our righteousness are as a filthy rag, and we all do fade as leaves, and our iniquities, like the wind, has taken us away. And Zabur, Psalms 51:5, behold, I was shaped in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. We have to go to the Torah further, and we have to go to the beginning, what happened at the fall of man. And let us read the curse of God. And unto Adam he said, cursed is the ground for thy sake, in sorrow shalt thou eat of it all the days of thy life. Thorns also and thistles shall it bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat the herb of the field. In the sweat of thy face shalt thou eat bread, till thou return into the ground, and out of it wast thou taken, for dust thou art, and unto dust shalt thou return. So it's very interesting. God said, well, now you're going to work for peanuts, hard, and you will die. And it's exactly what we're doing right now, until the present days. But something happened before that and after this. So let's read And the eyes of the and the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. Unto Adam also and to his wife did the Lord God make coats of skins and clothed them. Well, the question is, where did he get the skin from? An animal. What do you have to do to an animal to take a skin off? You kill it, right? So it was somebody died because of somebody's disobedience. Let's move on to the next chapter. And in the process of time it came to pass that Cain brought his, of the fruit of the ground an offering unto the Lord. And Abel he also brought of the firstling of his flock and of the fat thereof. And the Lord has respected unto Abel and to his offering, but unto Cain and his offering he had no respect. And Cain was very wroth, and his countenance fell. And the Lord said unto Cain, Why thou art wroth, and why is thy countenance fallen? If thou dost well, shalt thou not be accepted? And if thou dost not well, sin lieth at the door, and thou shalt be his desire, and unto it, and thou shalt rule over him. But what happened next? And Cain talked with Abel his brother, and came to pass, and they went to the field, and Cain arose up against Abel his brother, and slew him. Well, God basically said, well, you see the two different sacrifices, blood sacrifice by Abel and bloodless sacrifice by Cain, and both are sinners according to Genesis 3. And God said, well, I accept blood sacrifice, not bloodless sacrifice. You should know better, Cain. And you know what Cain did? Oh, you want blood, God? And he slew his brother, said, that's blood. And rebellion. Well, as we move on from Genesis 4 onward, Noah, Abraham, Job, everybody brought blood sacrifice. Like it's amount of blood sacrifice mentioned in the Torah and in the entire Old Testament. It's a huge. And well, we'll mention, we can go on and on. But what I want to show you, I will focus and make a small detour into the Abraham sacrifice. And he, God, said, Take thou thy son, thy only son, Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah, and offer him there for the burnt offering upon the mountains, which I will tell thee of. And surprisingly, like I saw, like many Muslims said, well, we are the Abrahamic faith, we belong to the faith of Abraham, and we do what Abraham did, and meaning like Abraham built the Kaaba, and he worshipped the way modern Muslims are worshipping, and etc. And of course, they have a Qurban, which is sacrifice festival. And you can see Eid al-Adha festival. Muslims around the world celebrate Ibrahim's willingness to sacrifice his son for Allah following the annual Hajj pilgrimage to Mecca. And of course, we have many different animals, thousands of animals being killed. The camels, cows, sheep, goats, etc. But what I find astonishing is, first of all, my son's out. Something is wrong. What I find it is like the Muslims during this festival time when they sacrificed animals in commemorating what Abraham did. So let me start.
I've stopped the time, Alex.
Yeah, thanks.
That up again, so it is on pause.
Thank you. Okay, I think I'm okay now. Let me start. And it seems to me like Muslims, what we do, they have one third of this sacrifice, whatever it is, they eat and then within the family. One third is given to relatives or friends, distant relatives or friends. And one third is given to complete strangers. Okay, now that's fine, it's very generous and it's nice and tasty for sure. But what is really this kind of sacrifice remind me of this sacrifice, what the Christians does in the West? It's called Thanksgiving Turkey. He thanks God for he provides for us and let us eat and be happy and merry, right? But let's go to Abraham's sacrifice. So we have a very interesting story here. Let us focus on two words. And God said, offer him his son Isaac, or Ishmael if you like, they are for the burnt offering upon the one of the mountains which I will tell thee of. And after that, and Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him a ram caught in the thicket by his horns. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered him up to the burnt offering instead of his son. Well, if you want to commemorate really sacrifice of Ishmael, I'm sorry, a sacrifice of Abraham, supposedly do it with Ishmael or Isaac, doesn't matter, you should not eat the sacrifice, but you should burn it down. Plus, let me bring the Torah in order to ask you all, is it okay to bring haram sacrifice to God, or it will be abomination? It's okay for Muslims to sacrifice the swine and eat from it? I don't think so. Let's go to the Torah and Leviticus. And it said, and the Lord spoke unto Moses and to the Aaron, saying to them, speak unto the children of Israel, saying, these are the beasts which you shall eat, all the beasts that are on the earth, among the all beasts of the earth. Whosoever part in the hoof and is cloven footed and chewed the cud among the beasts, that shall you eat. Nevertheless, those shall you not eat from them that chew the cud, or from them that divide the hoof, as a camel, because he chewed the cud but divided not the hoof. He is unclean unto you, haram. And verse 7, we have, and swine, though it he divide the hoof and be cloven footed, yet he chewed not the cud. He is unclean to you. Of their flesh thou shalt not eat, and their carcasses shall not you touch. They are unclean to you, haram. Therefore, you see, if the swine is haram, and also the camel is haram, according to the Torah. Well, sometimes I just went to the internet and find all these pictures, and we all know that the Muslims say, well, we love Jesus, Jesus is a prophet of Islam, Jesus is a Muslim, in the path of Abraham, and we have a three faith, one God, Judaism, Christianity, Islam, and we are all sons of Abraham. But yet it's very interesting, when I'm reading the Quran, it's as I'm driving on the car, on one road, and I see one landscape, and I go to a certain destination. But if I'm reading the Torah, or the Old Testament, I'm on a complete different landscape, and I'm going to a complete different destination. And it's just puzzling, why so? Why we have so many differences? As a matter of fact, we have almost nothing in common among us. And I think the reason is because we have, like Islam, the Quran speak differently of the story of Adam in the Quran, and the story of Adam in the Torah, they are completely different. So if we deviate in the beginning, as we progress, thriving from these two different roads, we have different Abraham, we have different Noah, we have different David, Solomon, and when we reach Christ, it's millions of miles apart, nothing in connection. We have nothing. Please stop. We have nothing in common. I have to say that. Let's go back to the prophets. Sacrifice. The all sacrifices from Genesis 3 goes to Isaiah 53, which I briefly mentioned. Now I'm going to read it to you. So most of the verses. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgression, he was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray, we have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him, he has put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed, he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. By his, he shall see his travail of his souls and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide spoils with the strong, because he hath poured out his soul into the dead, and he was numbered with the transgressor, and bare the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors. See, we have many verses speaking about what the Christians are using from Old Testament, proving Christ is a perfect sacrifice for sin of all mankind.
Aye.
So at this point, I think we've collected, is there another question here? There's a question here in the second pew. Okay. And we have two different boxes here. Which one is for Sadat and which one is for That's for Sadat. Okay, so Sadat, you've got the green box. Now let's see, you have the blue box, the recycling box. Okay. Yeah, okay. Now when I take the questions, ladies and gentlemen, I just want to make sure, if you're asking questions that are not relevant to the topic, we can't take them, because the debate is on, can we trust Hayes Torah? So questions that are unrelated to this topic, we really cannot address, because they're not pertinent to the debate. So we want the questions that are relevant to tonight's topic. And because time is of the essence, we don't want to waste our time or the time of our speakers. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to ask both Sadat and Alex to come up to the front and stand here by the podium. And I'm going to select the questions and ask them. So if you can come up. So the way this is going to work, I'm going to select a question, and the question to whom it's addressed, the person will have 2 minutes, and then the other person can have a minute. Okay? So I'm just going to randomly pick a question here, and this, the blue box is for Alex. Alex, many facts narrated in the Quran are confirmed in latest discoveries of Old Testaments. Please comment. If you need me to repeat that, I can. For Alex, many facts narrated in the Quran are confirmed in latest discoveries of Old Testaments. Please comment.
I don't understand what latest discoveries of Old Testament means and what is confirmed. Basically, when you read every story of Adam, Eve, and all the prophets to the Quran and to the Jesus Christ, you find them completely in disagreement with the Quran and the stories. I don't know what Quran is to confirm. It's basically, I will agree if the Quran said, well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, well, I sent the Quran to deny or correct the Torah, not to confirm. 14 places said it sent the Quran to confirm the Torah, and I have no idea what is to confirm. There's nothing to confirm. Basically, the Quran denies the Torah at the whole.
Okay. Would you like to respond to that, Beck?
Yeah, well, I'm just repeating myself that the Quran in chapter 2, verse 79, makes a general allegation without specifics of the Jews having tampered with the scriptures textually in written form. They wrote things and then they said it's from God. Do discoveries of Old Testament manuscripts prove that? To some extent, in a general sense, yes, because Dead Sea Scroll scholars are saying that the Torah was a very fluid text at the time of around 250 BCE, at the time of the Essene community there in the Qumran caves. They're confirming that, as I quoted earlier on, that scribes felt a freedom to add and to delete and to improve, quote unquote, improve the text in whichever ways they felt. So in that sense, it is confirming. We had the examples of Mount Ebal or Mount Gerizim, which one is the original. These are all examples that the Torah was a fluid text, even during the time of Jesus, and things were still being changed. Thank you.
Question for Sadat. This is a very long question, and okay, this one is not really relevant, so I'm going to have to pass on this. It's not relevant. Okay, question for Sadat. Seems like it's been corrupted, this note here. Sadat, look at that question. I don't know if that is a relevant question. Is that relevant to tonight's debate? You can take it if you want. If not, I can just pass, but I don't know if that's relevant.
want to take that?
I do understand.
Actually. Okay, let me read it out. Okay. Question for Sadat. How much of your arguments in percentage are non-Muslim skeptics' arguments?
I think I understand the question, that what percentage of the arguments that I used today were from skeptics, or did it say non-Christians, or did it say non-believers?
It said percentage of non-Muslim skeptic arguments.
Yeah, non-Muslim skeptic arguments. Yeah, they basically all were, because if I quoted Ibn Hazm or Ibn Taymiyyah, that wouldn't mean much to you. So I quoted from Ibn Ezra, I quoted from Richard Friedman, I quoted from people who are from the Judeo-Christian scholarly tradition. But I think, I might be mistaken, but I think the implication of the question is that these people are like atheists and agnostics, and why are you quoting them? They have like an anti-religious or an anti-supernatural bias or something like that. As I explained, today the Catholic Church, for example, does not take everything in the Old Testament. Literally, they believe that there are errors in the Old Testament. You don't have to accept it. You don't have to agree with the Catholic Church. But the point is, they don't have an anti-religious bias. They don't have an anti-supernatural bias or anything like that. Bart Ehrman is a good example of somebody who started out as an evangelical Christian. So when he was examining the Bible at that time, he wouldn't have had a skeptical view of the Bible. He was trying to view it from a faith perspective, but eventually he ran into problems that, you know, he couldn't answer. And if I could just, one quote is from, again, from Dr. Richard Friedman in Who Wrote the Bible. He said, "This investigation," meaning the textual investigation into the Bible, "did not develop as a controversy of religion versus science or religious versus the secular. On the contrary, most of the investigators were trained in religious traditions and knew the Bible as well as those who accepted the traditional answers. Indeed, from the outset to the present day, a significant proportion of critical biblical scholars, perhaps the majority, have been at the same time members of the clergy."
Thank you. Alex, would you like to respond?
Yes. As I said in the beginning of my first presentation, from a Muslim, I expect a lot of information or a lot of arguments supposed to come from the Quran, from the Hadith. But so far, what I see from the Quran and the Hadith is either confirmation of the Torah in the parts or in full. And if they said, well, it was corrupted, supposedly, then it was corrupted mainly, presumably, in the name of Muhammad, who was, peace be upon him, was removed from the Torah. That's very interesting, because we can see, if you're going to read this website of Bassam Zawari, you will see how many times the name of Muhammad, supposedly being removed from the Torah, was mentioned by early Islamic sources. So I just wonder, like, you have to go with these guys and accept them, and we can play around and see if it was indeed the name of Muhammad or his description was in the Torah, in any Torah we have right now.
Okay, thank you. Question for Alex. Alex, from a Christian perspective, when will the law and the prophets be fulfilled, or has it been fulfilled already through the life of Christ?
Some will already be fulfilled, some will be fulfilled. That's as close as I can.
Okay, that's the fastest answer we've had so far.
So I get to bounce off of that?
Yes, you get. I mean, he only answered in 6 seconds, but that's the you didn't respond. Now, if you could do it in 3 seconds, that would be very
easy. Yeah.
Go ahead, just say that.
Well, Christ is reported to have said in the Gospel of Matthew that, the stars are going to fall, and coming to my mind right now, but I think basically, in a nutshell, I would agree with Alex. Some of the prophecies have been fulfilled, and some of them have not been fulfilled.
Hey, they agreed together.
Okay, I think that's not. I don't think that's relevant to our talk. It's more impactful.
I can make it relevant to the talk.
Okay. We have a very interesting question here, a very existential question, and it's Sadat. Are you going to paradise/heaven? Why? And how do you know?
I can make this relevant to the Torah and to Alex's presentation. He said that the Adam, the Abraham, the Noah, the Lot, the David that he sees in the Bible, he sees no connection between what Muslims do. He doesn't see a connection between the Muslim versions of those prophets and the biblical versions of those prophets. Well, here's one parallel, or here's one resemblance right here.
Abraham didn't jump up and down and say he's saved. David, Noah, Lot, they didn't jump up and down and say they're saved. Moses, Jesus, Muhammad, they didn't jump up and down and say that they're saved. So it's nothing of shame for me to not jump up and down and say that I'm saved. I say that I'm going to paradise, inshallah, by the will of God. Now, just today, God put it in my heart, I guess, because during the Jummah or the Friday prayer service, the Imam recited from Surah Ada, in which it says, the afterlife is better. وَآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى هَذِهِ إِنَّ فِي هَذِهِ فِي سُهُفِ الْأُولَى فِي سُهُفِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَمُوسَى. So the Quran says that the afterlife is better for you than this world. You should be aiming for the afterlife. And it says this in the scriptures of Abraham and in the scriptures of Moses. So one question to throw back at you is, where in the Torah does it talk about paradise or salvation or heaven? It doesn't talk about that at all.
Okay. Would you like to respond to that?
Yes. I just want to add something to it. So from my research on the hadith, I find that some verses in the hadith of Muhammad, peace be upon him, speaking, he basically affirmed that every Muslim on this planet will eventually go to paradise according to several hadith. But most of them will go through the hell, like detour in hell temporarily, maybe for a million years, and then come back. But it's fine. In the Bible, it's actually speak about either you go to hell or heaven. If you find yourself, God forbid, in hell, there is no come out, no way out. Thank you.
Okay, Alex. You did not provide an explanation of the clear textual differences between the different Torahs. What is your criteria for accepting the Masoretic text over others?
Well, first of all, I mentioned and I said, I read some of the verses, of course, from versions, different versions, like Septuagint and King James Bible and Masoretic text, and they all agree that when Joseph was thrown and sold to Egypt, his father was crying, and father said, well, Joseph is without doubt rent in pieces, in different words, but the same narration. Narration had never been changed whatsoever. That's why I said, well, for me, it's irrelevant to say, well, maybe there's a words different, but they are all synonyms. They're all speaking about the same. But the Quran, in contrary, speaks completely different. It's 100% different. But all the Bibles on this planet, from this is called the earliest manuscript until today, the messages or whatever new Bible will be written and revised 100 times, it will still, the narration of Joseph and Jacob will still be absolutely the same. That's why I said they're virtually the same, they've never been changed. Thank you.
Okay.
I think a larger problem than the contradiction between the Bible and the Quran is the contradiction between the Bible and the Bible. That's a bigger problem. The Torah contradicting the Torah is a bigger problem than the Torah contradicting the Quran. Again, is it Genesis 1 or is it Genesis 2? Is it the animals created first or is it the humans created first? In regards to the Joseph story, I already pointed out a problem with that in the introduction, that you have a dream from God which is unfulfilled. The dream is Joseph sees the sun and the moon, i.e. both of his parents, and the 11 stars, his 11 brothers, submitting to him as the ruler of Egypt. That never happens. How do I trust the Torah when I can't trust a vision or a dream coming from God in the Torah? You have to be able to trust the God of the Torah. And also in that same very same story, who sold Joseph into Egypt? Was it the Midianites or was it the Ishmaelites? Every Bible in the world contains this problem. Which version is the correct one? Because you have different strands of writers. One strand says that the Midianites sold Joseph into Egypt. The other one says the Ishmaelites sold.
Thank you. Sadat, you quoted some scholars that the Old Testament text was fluid. How do you account for the Isaiah scroll from the Dead Sea Scrolls, which is the same as we have today? Is this not proof that the text has not changed?
I don't know, in all honesty, how many passages of Isaiah are there. I don't know if it's the complete scroll or not. You would know better than me. So that's fine. We don't have to deny that it has not been changed. Yeah, we don't have to deny that. Thank you. We don't have to deny that hasn't been. See, again, understand, Muslims are not saying everything's been changed, everything's been lost, everything's been corrupted. That's a black and white dichotomy that's being imposed on the debate, which I don't subscribe to. And similarly, even if we were to prove that the Torah, even though it's impossible because there are different Torahs, as I proved, but even if we were to prove one particular version of the Torah has never been changed, since the time of Jesus or before that, we're still left with the problem of the first 1,000 years. Just very quickly, I mean, if the police come knocking on my door and they say, Sadat, somebody got murdered in front of your house, sometime in the past 3 hours he was killed and you're a suspect. And I say, well, there's no way I could have done it because I didn't even leave the house for the past hour and a half. Well, okay, I didn't leave the house for the past hour and a half. What was I doing before that? The question still remains.
Alex?
Yes, I'd like to comment on that. And let's say if scholars will find, I mean, archaeologists will find not 2,000 years old scholar, Torah, but 3,000 years scholar, what will you say in order to deny the Torah? And second of all, I want to say about, one, will you accept Isaiah 53 to be unchanged? Because I quote from directly from the Dead Sea Scrolls, Isaiah chapter 53, and then I quote from Acts, two verses from Isaiah, and I just read entire Isaiah from King James Bible. So will you accept that this text was not changed? Will you accept that Christ was indeed crucified, and you need to accept him in order to be saved? Will you?
Thank you. Okay. All right, Alex, question for you. Genesis 37, verse 28 says, the Midianites, parenthesis Egyptians, sold Joseph to the Ishmaelites, parenthesis Arabs, who sold him in Egypt. Verse 36 says, Midianites took Joseph to Egypt and sold him there. Is this a contradiction, not an evidence of the documentary hypothesis?
Well, as I understand, Midianites and Ishmaelites were the same people in a sense, like we don't know how much they interact and intermarried within them. But yet we have to go to the story of Gideon and find that Gideon was years, 100 years after the story of Joseph of fighting in the northern part of Israel across the Jordan River, and he fought Midianites. And what happened? And he said, like, he took the rings of the camels, I think, the gold rings, and it said, why they have it? Because they were Ishmaelites. So it's the interchangeable name. That's why I understand. Thank you.
Okay, would you like to comment on that?
Yeah, if they were interchangeable names, then it doesn't make sense why the Midianites sold them to the Ishmaelites or vice versa. Why are they mentioned as two different groups? And then it specifically says in Genesis that I believe it was the Midianites sold them to the Ishmaelites. And the Ishmaelites took them down, but elsewhere then it says the Midianites took them down. So if they're the same group, why are they talking and doing business transactions with one another?
Question for Sadat. Sadat, what advice would you give to a Christian who doubts his or her faith? Spiritual advice. And why would someone become a Muslim? Please give spiritual advice related to faith, God, and prayer.
I think this question is a good example of why, and this partially answers a couple of the points that Alex had brought up during his presentation. Why would the Quran direct anybody to the Torah and say, you know, you don't stand on anything unless you stand by the Torah? In other words, hold firm to it. Why would it do that? It would do it for the same reason that I would do that. I would point a Christian, for example, back to the Torah, back to the first commandment. That here, O Israel, our Lord is one God. Our Eloh, it says in Hebrew, our Eloh is Ichad. Our Lord is one. Our Allah is one. Qul hu Allahu Ahad. So it's often due to expediency or for convenience that Muslims will do that. It makes sense to me that the Quran would do that as well. I'm ready to quote from Paul. You know, you think that we're enemies of Paul. I'm ready to quote from Paul. If a Christian came up to me and said, what do you think about me marrying, my gay partner? And he claims to be a Christian, well, I'm ready to even quote from Paul if it will bring him back to the proper path or bring him closer to the truth. So my advice to the Christian, in a nutshell, would be to reflect back on the Torah itself. What does the Torah prove? Does it prove that Abraham was worshipping the Son of God? Or was Noah worshipping the Son of God? Or was Lot worshipping the Son of God? Or were they just worshipping God like Muslims do?
It's time. Thanks. Alex?
Yes, I'd like to say that according to Islam, no child, for the Muhammad, peace be upon him, he said in the Hadith, no child was born but have Islamic faith, but parents will make him a Christian or Jew. According to Islam, we're all born pure. According to the Torah, Genesis 3, after Adam and Eve, we're all born sinners. Therefore, we require, how can we save ourselves? It's only through the blood of Christ, and all blood sacrifice, if you want to say it. So my understanding is salvation, there is how you can, Islam speaking about against fundamental truths we have right now. Even our children, as 2 years old, we call them terrible truths. They all are like, we know how to sing without even learning it. So the Torah is true, and I doubt that Islam, the tradition of Islam, the doctrine of Islam are true.
Okay, I think we are come to our final question for the night. Alex, I'll ask you this question, and then Sadat, you could comment. Alex, Isaiah 53, is it talking about the Messiah or the Jewish nation?
Well, very good question. Thank you very much for asking, because once I was talking to one Muslim guy in London, UK, and he said, well, I'm going to read Isaiah 53 and explain you differently what you think is Isaiah 53 is about. And I talked to Jewish people, and they exactly speaking about that's about nation of Israel compared to a Gentile nation. And that's fine, because we are the Christian, we understand the words differently. And Paul, Peter, eunuch, they all, Jew, they understood that verse like us, because that's why the concept of Messiah, sovereign Messiah came, and Christ was accepted as a Messiah by many Jews in the beginning. And then non-Jews became a Christian later on. But it's fine to have different opinions. What I tried to tell during this whole presentation, that the text itself has not been corrupt, and Jews will never remove the text from it, and therefore we have nothing, we cannot argue the text, or we can argue about how the text will interpret itself. And I think it's fine if you don't believe it, Christ is a suffering Messiah, you believe it's a Jewish nation, or whatever you want, that's fine with me. But one day you will stand before God who gave a Torah, and you will give an answer to him why you deny his word. Thank you.
Okay.
Well, even though the question is not relevant to whether the Torah is trustworthy or not, but we can consider Isaiah part of the greater Torah of the Jews, the preceding chapters and the subsequent chapters after Isaiah 53 both identify that suffering servant as Israel. So if I were to approach it in the same way that Christians approach Deuteronomy 18:18, they insist, you have to see Muhammad's name there. Where is his name spelled out? So by that criterion, we don't see Jesus anywhere in Isaiah 53. I don't think it's a foreshadowing of him. It doesn't mention that this is God himself in person and that it will be necessary for you to believe in him in order to gain salvation. Isaiah 53 doesn't mention any of that.
Thank you very much. And ladies and gentlemen, am I on here? Let me go up here. Ladies and gentlemen, I do declare the debate to be formally over. I do want to take this opportunity, however, to thank both Alex Grimley and Sadat Anwar for their wonderful work. And I also want to say that from the beginning, these two gentlemen have been cordial towards each other, and from the very beginning, they've been very understanding. They were the easiest people to deal with because they were mutually very friendly with each other. They didn't dispute issues, etc. And this is, I think, a wonderful sign of what dialogue is all about. And between Muslims and Christians and anyone else. And it's my hope that it doesn't end here tonight. The dialogue or the debate does not end here. Take what you've heard tonight. God has given us a mind to use for His glory. And truth is a very heavy matter. It's not a trifling matter. It is of an eternal significance. And so I would ask that you go from this place and go thinking about what you've heard tonight and considering the ramifications of what Sadat said or what Alex said. And also recognize that that most importantly, we are all part of the human family and that we are all sons and daughters of Adam. And that we are, in that sense, really brothers and sisters in Adam to each other. So let's go from this place in peace, and maybe sometime down the road, Alex and Sadat will be back with another debate to help educate us. Thank you very much, gentlemen.